You're listening to Bo and Tami After Hours. This is Monday night, April 14th, 9 p.m., 2014 here. Bo will be joining us shortly, and you're listening live on No Borders Radio, as well as These Changing Times Radio at thesechangingtimesradio.ning.com. That's T-I-M-E-Z with a Z there. And we are only listener supported. If you would like to donate, please visit us at our site, thesechangingtimesradio.ning.com, and click on our support pages. Every little bit helps. We wanted to throw together some after hours audio because there's so much going on and so many concerns. First of all, the psychopaths are out in full force. There is a YouTube video that Bo pointed out earlier today on YouTube by Danny Carlson. Cop cuts off longboarders, crash. Now, these kids in Canada were out skateboarding, and the cop pulled out in front of them. And the children had to move in order to not crash into the police or get run over. And, of course, this is nothing more than corporate policy, where human beings are worth less and less and less every day, including our own children. I urge everybody to go to YouTube. The video is called Cop Cuts Off Longboarders Dash Crash. In Canada, the Corporation of Canada, we're up in the ante now. We got a bus driver fired for picking up freezing kids in her SUV when her bus broke down. And this is, of course, on freerangekids.com. It starts out, folks, Canadian school bus driver Kendra Linden was about to pick up kids on a freezing cold day when her bus broke down. The recent times this had happened, she recalled, no replacement bus arrived. And so, with windshield temperatures dipping to minus 37 degrees Celsius, which is minus 34 degrees Fahrenheit, she took matters into her own hands and picked up the few students along her route in her SUV. Parents have since been writing letters on Linden's behalf, but so far it seems there's no chance of an appeal because rules are rules. Kids don't matter. We're not protecting kids. We're out protecting corporate policy. Now they're making this big stink that she had little people in the back of her SUV without any seatbelts on. I'm sorry, but I was once a plebeian citizen, and my parents sent me out back and forth to public school, otherwise known as Hitler Youth Camps, on a bus without seatbelts. Not once did we have seatbelts. And we've lived in various places, including Fairbanks, Alaska, where the moose population is a lot higher than the bus population. And we had many, many, many scares, never with a seatbelt. And at one time, we were on the bus when a truck jackknifed in front of us and knocked us over a hill. We were just teetering on the side of a cliff, no seatbelts. Now, that's not a reason for her firing, is it? She was fired because kids could have died, but they didn't. And those children that could have died would have brought many, many, many death derivatives into the municipal coffers. And again, I will say this loud and clear to Scotland and the UK, England and Greece, Australia, and the United States of America, which is a style. Get your kids out of the Hitler Youth Camp. Stop screaming about this core testing. Stop screaming about these school lunches. Now another parent got another notice. You can't send any food to school with your kids. We need to feed them USDA food that's supplied through the schools. Well, why is that? Well, go to the USDA. Go to the FDA and the contracts with the Ethics Commission, and you'll find that human beings are human test subjects. You'll find that the testing models or the model theories are prisons and public schools that they test many, many foods in. Approved by the USDA means it's approved for study, not approved for consumption. This is eugenics. It's right in front of your face. Corporate policy means we're maintaining corporate welfare off of the backs of human beings, making sure that no corporation, no bank, no judge, otherwise known as a banker, no attorney, otherwise known as a banker, will ever go hungry until you stand up and get Satan out of your midst. I was teaching a class earlier and we got back into attorney work product doctrine. And we need to have this according to their own writings, you know, to maintain an adversarial system. Go look up the word Satan. The etymology on the word Satan means adversary. So while you're all dancing around and you're looking for this forked tongue red fellow with the horns on his head, you need to look down there at the local law firm or bank and you'll find Satan. Which brings us to accountability. From Cincinnati.com earlier today, Florence attorney charged with stealing from clients. A veteran Florence attorney who had been in jail for 5 months has been charged with stealing hundreds of thousands of dollars from his clients. Boone County Sheriff's Office say John Arnett also forged court records and bank statements to cover up his theft over the last 13 years. Hello? You're making these individuals, these attorneys, this Satan executor over your states. You're allowing these bankers to be the conservator of your estates. Now they have an oath to Congress to discharge their bankruptcy as their conservator under 28 U.S.C. subsection 453, judicial oath. Now, when you delve into what a judge is and you go to the Federal Magistrate and Judges Association, and then you look at what these magistrates are and what they've always been, go all the way back to Sparta. These are the same E-4s, E-P-H-O-R-S, as the E-4s of Sparta. These are the things tricking you out, pimping you out, you Spartan citizens. What's a Spartan citizen? Anybody who can hold enough concepts to patronize or call a fictional government their father. Of course, Jesus always said what? Call no man your father, not even Christ. Well, what do? Patronize your own house. Stop patronizing the House of Representatives. That thing, so far, you've been calling it your father. Constitution right there says so. Says you've vested power in Congress. Senate and House of Representatives in Congress. What does it say in 1 Corinthians 6? You can only fornicate by giving your body over to the Lord God. And it also says, God has raised up the Lord God, so shall he raise us up by his own power. How do you do that? Get out of the House of Representatives and live in your own house. Patronize your own house. Stop buying these concepts, which only comes from the tree of knowledge. A tree of knowledge bears fruit called concepts. What does it say in Genesis, or the action of biogenesis, which means away from life, mind, and soul? Well, the Greek translation said, God accepted concepts. He took up concepts and called them good. Sold to you by none other than the law merchant. That makes us the whore of Babylon, doesn't it? Aren't we purchasing all these things from a law merchant, giving it our bodies and fornicating? Telling it to be our fathers? Come on. You know you want to say it. But the founding fathers. There you go. Start there. Start there where you first began to be raised openly. Start there when you were first called a plebeian citizen. Start at the Articles of Confederation. Article 12 says you're pledged and you're charged to discharge congressional bankrupt states. Again, in 1794, they came in with one of the Jay Treaties there, the Treaty of Amity, Commerce, and Navigation, and they got you with mail. They got you by posting you. How does that work? 18 U.S.C. subsection 1342 says you're a felon if you're claiming that patented last name and not the proper name. Proper name's only your first and middle. Cognomen is the last name or family name. What's a family name? Oh, it signifies you're a new species of human. That's what it has a patent on. You're not calling yourself part of the body of Christ. You're calling yourself something altogether different. A new family, a new genus, a new species, a new stock to be traded on that stock market. It's disgusting. Yesterday we were talking about the story of Job, and hopefully when Bo gets on we can talk more about that. But for now, from Philly.com, suspended lawyer faces new charges in Delaware. Delaware Attorney General Bo Biden, of course that's Joseph Biden's little boy, running the gamut with his PR campaign here, has announced the indictment of suspended lawyer Michael Kwasnick on charges of theft, securities fraud, and sale of unregistered securities, the latest in a string of law enforcement and regulatory action against him. Kwasnick of Marlton pleaded guilty to New Jersey money laundering charges a year ago in connection with the theft of $1.1 million from a 96-year-old Cherry Hill widow. What does it say in the Bible about that stuff? It says when that which is perfect is come and that which is in part is done away, then Satan doesn't exist. Females are no longer held in shadow, and widows don't have to worry about getting remarried in order to protect their estates. Why do they have to get remarried? Because there's attorneys preying on them. 96-year-old widow. And you'd be surprised how often attorneys are killing elderly individuals. More than you even can imagine. As we've shared on Leaving the Farm and the Bo and Rocco Show, throughout the span of a year, we shared with you the genocide of human beings, how it's facilitated. I was on the phone with a doctor killing Joseph Reynolds at the time that Joseph Reynolds was being murdered by not only this doctor, but the attorneys behind the scenes. How did he get there? Somebody broke his nose. That same somebody was a guardian. That same somebody was an attorney who had an emergency situation and had to put Joseph Reynolds in the hospital. No, you're pulling my leg, Tammy. This is a month after they killed Bo's mother. And we watched that play out from start to finish. A suggested diagnosis without any pathology of cancer. They killed her by chemical warfare. Chemotherapy. And after the chemotherapy burnt holes in the frontal lobe, they killed her with some radiation. How did they do that? Well, they're doping everybody up, including you, the listener, with drugs used for lethal injections. Shut down the body's functions so that you can rest peacefully. To the benefit of these attorneys cashing in on debt derivatives when you become a risk against your pension or the insurance. We need to weigh and measure everything, everybody, and make sure that we're keeping each other safe, because this is sick. They're trying to kill our kids in Canada. Trying to run them over using the cops. And then they called the kids bad boys because they shouldn't have been there, right? The cop pulled right out in front of those boys. It's just absolutely deplorable that there could be any such thing as patriotism or calling these things your father. Sick. Sick, sick. I think we've got Bo. Are you there, Bo?
Yeah, I'm just putting some announcements on, just trying to get my act together here after being out all day. Okay, so I'm back in. Okay, what's been going on here?
Well, I wanted to cover that freaking one.
I was up late last night reading, he wanted to change his name to Ian Freeman and just do it on his driver's license, from what I gathered on it.
Which, of course,
let's see, let me pull that back up here so I can get on the page with you. Did you already read that one, or?
Yes, I skimmed through it because I thought it was very, very interesting. The false flag tactics that were in it as well. So this guy, he doesn't do any F&E docs, he doesn't do any of our
No, he's one of these patriot guys out there, the freaking community or something like that. There's something about a whole community they're trying to, they're advertising, they're building, and...
Right. Well, the headline for all of the listeners is, kidnapping is poor customer service, why was I arrested yesterday? Why I was arrested yesterday.
Yeah, kind of like Rod Class saying, you need to administrate me better. You're not following the rules.
Absolutely.
We've got the rules of procedure right here, Judge E. Poo.
Right.
Judge Your Honor. He calls me Your Honor, I think.
Oh, it's sick.
He's in there pleading like a good plebeian, I guess.
It's sick. Honor is a state of being that only comes from not being in a bankrupt state. Congress has been bankrupt since 1933, according to its own documents. It came in as a trustee over its own bankruptcy. So these judges can never be an honor. You can never call them your honor because they're not even at liberty, which is a franchise granted within honors. I mean, these things are absolutely disgusting. So I'll start reading. Quote, if you've been reading the Freaking blog for the last year, you know that in the summer of 2013, the NHDMV suspended my driving privileges indefinitely until I got a New Hampshire driver's license. You also know that for many years I've been using the name Ian Freeman without going through the probate process to change my name legally. In my interactions with the state and city, this name change, in fact, has had mixed results. I was able to successfully register to vote as Ian Freeman and run for office under that name, but most courts would not recognize my name change.
Well, yeah, you can do criminal things in a criminal organization, right? Did they ever revoke the fact that they're a confederacy, which is a criminal enterprise?
No, that's what the definition of confederacy is a criminal enterprise, otherwise known as conspiracy. So this Freeman guy, he got arrested for using a fictional name. And he's wondering why he's arrested. Do you have any idea, Bo?
Yeah, well, because he's claiming to be a citizen on one hand. He's registering for stuff. And then he goes and registers his name other than what they have in their franchise papers on him. And so it's clearly a violation of 18 U.S.C. 1342.
Right, and Freeman, like Morgan Freeman, Freeman is actually a patented last name. It's a description that Congress already owns. They own that name. They're the ones that allowed you the fictional description. And we can go into that in depth at another time. You can listen to it in prior audios. For example, the quote, legal nomen that I was given upon my birth or docking in the United States Incorporated, which was in Alaska, was Eric's son. That's a description of years past. Of course, I'm not Eric's son. My father's name wasn't Eric. And such as Rocco, Larson. And you have others. Smith indicates that you're a blacksmith or a silversmith. These are things you can do or things that you are. They do not and are not proper names. They are patented names, and that's where the letters patent come in. They're the ones that are calling you those things. And when you attach yourself to those names, that's when that estate is going to be charged to protect you from yourself, because you're acting as a fiction. You're acting as an infant, and they have a requirement to protect you as an infant. This guy, he sounds, you can go to his site at freekeen.com. Yeah. And look at those things. But he seems awfully surprised that he was arrested for using that fiction. And for all of the listeners out there, again, go to 18 U.S.C. subsection 1342, and you can read about the use and assumption of those fictional names and addresses.
Well, this is another example, another fine example, how they're playing both sides of the mind here. Because on one hand, they're recognizing the authority of this federal state, this confederacy, all their codes and statutes, and you know, on the other hand, they're within that system complaining about it, say we're not being administrated correctly. And
right, Lincoln came in the 14th Amendment, and he declared all of the corporations as living beings called persons. Okay, so all the corporations got life at that time. Now, to insure those corporations and to make sure that they never go hungry, insurance was brought out, life insurance accounts, life insurance policies. When you enter into their jurisdiction, you are subscribing to that jurisdiction, which means you are the underwriter of that policy. Let that sink in. You are insuring that your estate is going to be charged. You are going to be put in prison. You are going to be hospitalized. You are going to be euthanized through lethal injection. You're going to be taken care of by that other daddy, the Lord God.
Well, he'll take care of you, all right. He took care of that Ian Freeman, didn't he?
And Job. It's the story of Job. It's the perpetual story of Job, and we were talking about that yesterday. And it's just been profound, absolutely profound to, you know, not only listen to the reactions of the students, but then, you know, interacting over the story of Job. And in the end, you know, Job got double, which was nothing because he had been raised. And then, of course, the community came in and donated a whole bunch of stuff. And he had some stuff, which is the Matthew 27. Judas comes into the chief priests and elders, and he says, here's that silver back. I just realized what I've been doing, and I want to give this back. And they said, oh, we can't put that in the treasury. We have to make it look charitable. That stuff is blood money. Well, where did that come from? Federal Reserve notes. You can't put Federal Reserve notes back in the treasury. Those come from special drawing rights and protecting Job while you're burning his house down based on an insurance claim.
Yeah, what most people fail to see there, you know, thanks to the priest interpreting the scriptures, priests and scribes, they fail to see the exact same thing going on today, and that the Lord God is like corporate counsel, which represents the federal state, Congress, and, you know, where the fourth generation warfare is coming into play. And then at the very end of it all, he gets stuff back from the community, not back from the federal state, but the federal state will take the credit. Yeah. But all the children and all the livestock that was lost, you can't replace children.
Absolutely not.
So yeah, I see it as, again, another confirmation of the 0.82% return when you file charges on a lawsuit and go through the court industrial complex. you get your 0.82% back, just as stated in the second welfare theorem.
Right, first and second welfare theorem, as well as in the debenture participation program run by the Small Government Loan Service, which is now called the Small Business Administration. And you can go right now to the SBA.gov and keyword CUSIP, C-U-S-I-P, and debenture participation. Now, debenture is a debt secured by your own earning power. It is not a loan. It's a debt secured by your own earning power. So what you're doing as a pledged asset is securing that debt and paying it down through debenture, the action of debenture, working it off. You can be entered into the hospital. You can be entered into the psychiatric administration game. You can be criminalized, falsely accused, and put in jail. These are means of production. Consumption is another means of production. If they can sell you just about anything. I was watching this commercial the other day about a new depression medication. Okay, and this thing is all flowery and it's all pretty. And then these little characters start walking on the scene, and they each have a little winder in their backs. As it's advertising this prescription, it's showing you that it's making you into an automated robot. But you'll run out and buy it because it sounds really good, and it'll help with your depression, although it causes suicidal tendencies, and one of the side effects is death. It's the same thing with, what was that one for migraines? Imitrex. Now, if you have a headache, for example, and you take this Imitrex, one of the side effects is that it causes tuberculosis. Now, tell me what the trade-off is there. Tell me who benefits if you have a headache and you take a pill and you get TB. Who benefits from that? Who owns the hospitals? Attorneys. Who's sitting on the board of trustees? Attorneys and insurance agents. Who owns the nursing homes? Attorneys.
Who owns the media?
Attorneys. You can go right now to the Broadcasting Board of Governors, which is bbg.gov. Go to their about pages, and it says right there, they have full international control of all civil media. They're going to feed you anything, Job. And you're going to buy it. As to the story of Job, we did a documentary. We first did it in three parts called Guarantee Insurance. And then we put it all together into a documentary over on Bono's Entertainment. And it's called Guarantee Insurance, the documentary. And inside of that, we detail through media accounts and recent occurrences how insurance agents burn things down to make claims, and how insurance agents and FBI agents and CIA agents flood things for you. How principal agents at schools burn schools down accidentally, of course.
And at the same time, they're putting their foot in the door saying that, oh, these people are messed up. They need our help. And then they get in there and they help them to death some more.
Absolutely, and that's the whole premise of the whole game. 1864, with the 1864 Geneva Convention, they established the Red Cross as a place to store prisoners of war. Red Cross, of course, is also a symbol for hospitals. In 1929, they came in with the Geneva Convention of 1929, and they said, well, you know what? Just in case we ever fail, or if our government ever goes bankrupt, the corporations will be here to pick up people as prisoners of war and save them. They'll be held in holding corporations. They won't be held under the corporations themselves. They'll be held in holding corporations, which is such as Northern Holdings and Trust, as negotiable instruments. This is in 1929, of course, posturing for 1933, when Congress declared bankruptcy and came in as a trustee over its own bankruptcy. What a tricky, tricky, tricky business to put human beings in holding corporations. and teach them to live in little boxes. And we just saw citizens agreeing to that out in Nevada, right, where the Bundy Ranch is. They were standing there in First Amendment boxes, calling out for their phones. And
oh, they self-created First Amendment boxes. So the media's over here. We're going to go stand over here with the media.
Yep.
That was Pete Silly or whatever his name is.
Right.
Another constitutionalist. Just, you know, I mean, if you're stuck in that constitutional loop, you're going to miss the big picture, because what's going on there in Nevada, and in a similar story I just covered in Colorado, where a couple's cabin is under seizure by eminent domain, and the federal state's got a claim on it, you know, and then they go to the national state, the county, asking for help, you know, to make the, you know, sanction the road a, sanction a county road so they don't get in trouble for driving their snow vehicle up there. And the county says, well, no, we're going to have to seize your property because of, you know, to protect the environment or some nonsense. Okay? So, again, back to the Bundy Ranch. You know, the feds come in there, the BLM. And, you know, finally the sheriff steps up, not to protect Bundy Ranch, Clive and Bundy. He's protecting his interest.
Absolutely.
Of the national state, the county.
And it's all the same all over. The CIA is doing these productions to make it look like it's a local state, and the local state is doing the productions to make it look like it's a federal state. And they have no idea. These law enforcement officers have no idea that they're being pit, as well as humanity, against themselves and each other. And in this is creation of the next civil war, just like the one last time when Congress came in and made slavery lawful, legal. They said, oh, slavery's legal. Law enforcement is enforcing those laws. And citizens are like, what the hell is going on here? And law enforcement is enforcing those laws. Oh, it's policy. Gotta do my job. This is how I get paid. This is how I put food on my table. And at that time, citizens and law enforcement, of course, are killing each other because of this. And Congress is laughing their asses off as they run off to the bank. These things are just so
sick. Can you say that on the
sick.
Air?
Well, hopefully. I apologize to anybody I offend with my foul languages. Children are almost run over in Canada by cops.
I don't care about PR. I just care about being broadcast to as many people as possible. You know, so whatever we got to do.
Yeah.
Over at the Investment Watch, I think there's a story that kind of plays into the same thing. Now, it's a video, so I'm not going to be able to play it and get the full gist of it, but it says Russia hits out at criminal orders from Kiev to wage war on own citizens. And again, we see Job in this.
Absolutely, and that's what the National Security Act did of 1947. It was a declaration of war against the citizens, securing the national state, which of course is each corporation. Military was redefined in the 1947 National Security Act. And for all of everybody listening right now, this is, oh, that's America or whatever. Congress got global governance with the Atlanta Charter in 1941 when Roosevelt and Winston Churchill signed an agreement to human traffic amongst each other. This includes Scotland and Ireland and Canada and Australia, Greece, and everybody who's member of the IMF.
And they sold it to all the sheeple. It's such a good thing. Oh, we got the Atlantic Charter. It's agreement. It's a win-win scenario. Well, it's a win-win scenario for Congress, which is this league, which is global since then. And, of course, you know, the plebeians get human traffic. So it's not a win for, you know, the 7 billion human beings on the planet now, but for Congress, they'll call that a success.
Absolutely. And again, we've been holding them accountable. You can go find the genocide order read aloud on Boner's Entertainment. And in this, we said, okay, that's your form of government. You're going to choose it. It's going to be the same way that you're entered into the holding corporation as you did with human beings, including all of their other rules. 1978, they came in with the Inspector General's Act and insured everybody that was deposited into these banks and holding corporations through Federal Deposit Insurance
Corporation. There's your Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation that worked for you. What do you think of the FDIC now?
Yeah, it's just, it's foul what they've sold to humanity and what humanity has bought. You know, you've got...
They're still flying them pirate flags, them red, white, and blue pirate flags, you know, behind that Cliven Bundy as he's speaking to the patriots out there that are supporting him, you know. So he's using the patriots for one thing, okay? And the sheriff comes in, and he leverages all that leverage that the rancher has to protect his interests against the federal state coming in and, you know, getting the, you know, raising the Bundy Ranch and collecting the assets directly instead of going through the county or the national state where, you know, they do all the plundering and they kick back, like, I think, what is it, 60% to the federal state?
No, 90%.
90, yeah.
The counties have been being raised since 1974 with the Reclamation Act.
So the sheriff's only got like 10% interest. And
less than that. And
the BLM, though, has got 90% interest if they win.
Right.
You think they're going to back off forever?
Well, the sheriff, according to their own documentation, it says the sheriff gets 7% up to the first, like, 3,000, and then after that, it's like 3% or something like that. I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous because these are the troops on the ground that are putting their life in danger as Congress pits everybody against themselves and each other, and they're not getting paid very much, but the administration is.
And so for you people out there that think, okay, it's a good thing if you know, I you know, stayed in my parking space 1 minute past the hour that I paid for in the parking meter, I guess that's a good thing to go help the community out. Well, no, only 10% of that fine that you got charged is going to your community anyways.
Right.
And then they're just leveraging that out and pillaging that. So,
right.
It, you know, it never goes back to help you.
No, and the sheriffs aren't aware of all of the unclaimed assets. And one of the major ones is undistributed child support. When the county administration pretends that it can't find the mother of the children or the custodial parent, it'll save those funds in the municipal coffers. And in that, what they're doing is they're taking loans out on those amounts as if those are their assets. And then they have to pay them back. Well, why do you think that males are being arrested at a very high rate of speed and they have mandatory arrest laws? Because they're paying back those loans on money that males have already paid out for the support of their children that the municipalities are raising. And they were allowed to do that under ERISA, the Employee Retirement Insurance Securities Act. Everybody needs to start reading these acts because they're criminal acts. They're nothing but criminal acts. 16 U.S.C. 7, the Preservation Act. We were talking about that earlier today. Clinton came in and gave the presidency more power with an executive order from Clinton in 16 U.S.C. 7. And everybody needs to be aware of these things because if you read even one of them, you'll realize that you're being human trafficked and this is genocide. This is the same eugenics program that Margaret Sanger implicated back at the turn of the century in the 1900s. And the same eugenics program that Hitler carried on, and the same eugenics program that moved from Nazi Germany over to the America. Same thing. It just has a different face. It looks really pretty now because they've sold you the medical industry. They've sold you the psychological industry. How did it start in Nazi Germany? How did it start in Bolshevik Russia? Oh, there's a whole bunch of overhead, right? Whole bunch of people on state employ and federal employ 1927, the Bayer Corporation came in and said, you know what, Congress, who maintains the war courts, by the way, this is through a court action, you can read about this, and it's on my Facebook wall. You know what, we've got a bunch of overhead, and we need to indemnify Poland now. And what you saw was not, as Nazi Germany, was Congress taking out all of the law enforcement, teachers, doctors, and everybody else on state employ. The citizen always produces. They weren't killing Polish citizens. They weren't killing Jewish citizens. They were culling defunct product of a corporation that had already met its use, and they were cutting overhead. Let that sink in, because at that time they called them useless bread gobblers. And today, over on that video that I was speaking about earlier on YouTube, what was it called? Cop cuts off long borders.
Yeah, I got that pulled up now because I was going to comment on that.
Those children were dehumanized by corporate policy.
Well, let's break it down here. Let me go back here. So this ties into the eugenics program with the world of commerce, which is the law handed down by these lawmakers that you're voting for and corporate counsel attorneys that now that write the police policy directly. Okay, all those books of policy and papers, memorandums, emails sent out to all law enforcement, they all come from attorneys. Okay? Now, in Vancouver, a West Vancouver police officer in an unmarked SUV abruptly swerves in front of a group of longboarders, skateboarders for you old schoolers, to enforce a $35 bylaw violation. Luckily, everyone managed to avoid the reckless maneuver, and this footage doesn't have to be used in court. Now, the point of the matter is that this cop like pulls into their lane, so these guys got to skate out of the way. Now, how easily could have that gone badly? You all know how fast accidents can happen for those of you that have escaped minor accidents and are still with us. But, many times they result in serious harm or death. And these guys aren't protected by any metal boxes with four wheels. All right. Now, it's a violation of their attorney laws to be out there skateboarding, on the roads, which are owned by the people. I mean, they've siphoned your wealth to build these roads, and you can't use them unless you're in a properly registered vehicle with proper up-to-date tags and carry a license from the corporate state. They're just raking in hand over fist. Now this cop comes into their lane head on, and he's chastising these people for skateboarding and breaking the law, and he almost killed them. Now this is, again, this is an attorney mindset of laws, and law means to lay down. They got you to lay down to this ridiculousness that the attorneys write books and books and pages upon, to basically overturn the consensus reality and common sense.
Humanity itself.
Yeah, so it's more important. I wrote a comment on here that's been fairly well received, so I'll just read that. Via police policy handed down by corporate counsel attorneys, enforcement of commercial crimes is much more important than human life and the well-being of humanity. Now, a bunch of people that are agreeing with that, but I see some CIA agentry out there, saying, well, if you do a crime, you got to do the fine, right. And all this nonsense.
Well, and then one of them came on, a CIA agent, and he's like, well, cops are in danger and citizens are bad and everything else, and so we called him out as a CIA agent. This is what the federal government does. It pits cops and citizens against each other so they can kill each other, and it makes it easier to kill each other.
And then they cash in through the court process once again.
Right.
District attorneys stuff in their pockets.
Right, and if you want an example, go to the Southern Poverty Law Center, which has been defined as a domestic terror cell in federal court. And go look at the board of directors, go look at the leaders of the Southern Poverty Law Center, and you'll find that the CIA sits right there. This is a CIA product. Black people are bad, gay people are bad, straight people are bad, brown people are bad, and this is all they promote day after day, moment after moment. Everybody's bad, humanity's horrifying. Now, I want everybody to focus right now, not just on the cop that almost ran over the child, but on the informant that called the cops out there in the first place.
Yeah, there you go. There's the police state Nazi Germany stuff that is, again, another product from the attorneys, you know, get you to turn on each other, and that helps them cash in. So it's a good win-win business schematic for the attorney. But this is in a YouTube video, by the way, just for those who want to go see it, put out by Danny Carlson. It's on my front page of recent activity at Bono's Entertainment YouTube channel, if you want to get to it that way. But, you know, again, we're thankful there's nothing, no serious harm came of it, but this just shows you the mindset of cops created by the attorney. You know, I mean, is this what we really want? Or do we want law enforcement to come out and enforce public law?
Which is do no harm. And to the informant, I don't care why you called, but you called on a child that almost got killed and run over by a cop because of your actions against that child. It wasn't for that child. You didn't protect that child. You're required to protect all children, by the way. You're obligated. So you're off the little list there when it comes time for accountability. Sick. Absolutely horrifying that you wouldn't protect children and you'd protect landscaping over a child, corporate policy over a child.
Now, yesterday I also covered a death of a fashion model. She was 23 years old, okay? And I don't know if this is just a coincidence or some kind of Illuminati numerology thing, but because of a $230 medical fee, she laid on the floor for 12 hours and slipped into a coma and later died succumbing to these head injuries. But she finally got help to go to the hospital by fire department personnel. But when she got there, you know, there was no one there to pay her $230 medical fees. Her family wasn't even notified until 12 hours later. You know, at which time they found her on the floor, basically dying, half naked. Nobody even covered her up. And, you know, the damage had been done. You know, these head injuries can cause brain swelling. And doctors know how to treat that. They got to, you know, it sounds brutal, but they do have to drill a hole in the skull to relieve the pressure. But brain swelling is going to kill you. So, you know, but, you know, $230, nobody's going to pay that. Well, we're just going to let you lay on the floor and die.
Well, these models are highly insured as well. Models and actors and actresses. And so when an attorney kills them, the attorney cashes in more than they would on the average citizen, which is absolutely disgusting for all of you actors and models out there. When you're taking up these insurance policies, the attorneys target you for redistribution, and we're watching that with Justin Bieber. We just watched it with Mickey Rooney and his family. He was redistributed before his
Bob
death.
Geldof's daughter died. She was 23 years old.
Yep, it's absolutely.
What are all these 23 numbers coming up here for recently?
It's horrifying. They're targeting anybody holding insurance because that's what it is. It ensures their well-being and the corporate structure.
And as I pointed out in my video, Dick Cheney is aged out after 70, according to their own attorneys. You know, he's 71, and he's right first in line to get a heart transplant. No problem. We'll keep this evil old codger alive. We need him.
But Down syndrome children and babies don't get heart transplants or any other transplants because they're not productive members of society. They want produce. They want product. They want animals on a farm. Why would attorneys even consider transplantation for the mentally infirm? Hello, Nazi Germany. For the disabled? Hello, Nazi Germany. For the mentally retarded or anybody with Down syndrome? Hello, Nazi Germany. They only want product.
Yeah, they can spend billions and billions developing weapons to, kill countless numbers of human beings in wars that they created. But these attorneys that run hospitals are going to let you die on the floor because you didn't pay a $230 medical fee first.
And that's just their excuse. They're cashing in the death derivatives on the back end, and again, the insurance. Now, we saw one come through from CNN we wanted to take care of, too. CNN.com. Police: Utah mom admits to killing at least 6 of her babies. Now, and this happens every day. You don't see these charges because attorneys define neonaticide and infanticide as something other than child murder, for example. Now, you know the statistics that the welfare.gov puts out, the Department of Health and Human Services. You see those statistics that say mom kills about 1,200 children a year on average. But those are only, quote, children or the child defined by attorneys. There's 35,000 infanticides and neonaticides in the same corporation, the United States of Incorporated, every single year that's not reported because those babies are under a year old, so they're not defined as a child, according to attorneys, these psychopaths that determine life and death, because you allow them to represent you or represent you as life and death. You're allowing the attorney to tell you when you live and, of course, when you are thought of or conceived.
Or when your money is inflated or deflated.
Everything. And for
every aspect of your life, absolutely, yes. Oh, right. And Gelnoff's daughter was 25, by the way, to correct my error.
Right. It's sad. She went through a lifetime of hell, of course. That's the story of Job over and over again. Each one of our listeners can, go back through your relative experience and you'll find, oh my gosh, I am Job. Yes, that is the story of you. That the Old Testament is the story of you patronizing the Lord God. And the new one is your walk.
Well, I guess the story of about her is she was always kind of narcissist type of, I don't know how to describe her personality, but, she didn't really have a lot of purpose, and her kids came along, and she was starting to get the gist of life, what it was all about, and find meaning in her life when they killed her off,
right,
or whatever happened. I don't know. We don't have any direct evidence yet, but knowing how these things work, Job all over again, yada yada. I'm very suspicious. People don't just die at 25.
Absolutely.
When they're nothing, no medical problems found prior. And they're happy with their lives at that point,
Right, and she was so happy to be a mom. And, you look back at her past, and what I saw was that her mom was a victim of the story of Job at the hands of attorneys, of course. And all of these things compiled, and yes, of course, somebody's going to be reacting. Aristotle says that we're not adults until we reach about 28 or 29 years of age, as that's when our mind and our perception is, quote, cured or solidified. That's when we start making decisions that aren't based on impulse and rushing off towards the media supplementary details on what life is. And these things are horrifying. They did that to a mother down in Louisiana a couple weeks ago. I reported on that. Same thing. All she ever wanted to be was a good mom. She went to pick up her four-month-old child from the child's father and another female, most likely an agent, met her there and pulled a restraint on her and said that she was irate and all of these things. They stuck her in this jail in Louisiana, and she died in there because they wouldn't give her much-needed prescription medication. Of course, I frowned on those things, but... these things are horrible.
Yeah, here's some more background on her while we're still talking about Geldof's daughter. And Bob Geldof, for those that don't know, he's the guy that played Pinky in Another Brick in the Wall by Roger Waters and Pink Floyd. But she was, she had a column, a forum, and she was outing the women that gave their babies to... pedophile Seville. Lost Prophets singer
Seville, or was that Seville case, I believe?
Yeah, and then got threatened by lawsuits, and then 6 months later she's dead.
Right.
She's a member of the OTO, Ordo Templi Orientis.
And everybody who wants to know about more, Jimmy Seville case is really big in the UK. You could probably find out more information on the Daily Mail, those types of reporting sources, but goes all the way up to the top, and it's the same story as Job. It's the same story that William Cooper came out with, Behold a Pale Horse. It's the same conspiracy of silence that was banned from being aired on the Discovery Channel way back when by Congress. Well, why is that? What was going after Congress and the White House and everybody in your government that you patronize that are taking your children and sexually abusing them as a means of forcing them into production, the same production method as found in Greece called the Eros. This is not funny, anybody. You're putting your children in these positions of predation. You're putting them in school where there's a principal agent willing to prey on them. You're putting them with Catholic priests in Sunday school.
So you're gonna bust them out, all over in California where they just had that FedEx crash into the bus. You ever driven around the LA area? That's insane that anybody wants to live near a big city like that. And, people drive like idiots, of course, because they can't pull everybody over. So 55 becomes 75 speed mile an hour when it's bumper to bumper, which is just, it's insane to me. I hate big cities anyways. But, they're busing these kids to school in this traffic, and then there's fatal accidents on the highway, of course, that we just saw in California,
caught my interest because when it first came out, it said there was a fire and FedEx truck was on fire when it hit the bus. Well, then a couple weeks later here, it says, no, there was no fire. They did the same thing with Nancy Schaefer. When they murdered Nancy Schaefer, they said that it was a murder-suicide and her husband shot her in the head because he had cancer. And then they waited until the sheeple forgot all about it and said, oh, he never had cancer. Okay, so why were they killed by senators? And that's the bottom line, folks. Nancy did a report to Congress on the corruption of child protection.
Nancy Schaefer, right?
Right. It was the same thing with all of us. George went the year before, they vilified him, and when they killed George Zinkon, they said, oh, he went up into the Georgia mountains, buried himself, and then shot himself in the head. Come on, people. You have to stop buying into these things because you alone, you the listener, you are the informant. You are the ones that are allowing our brothers and sisters to be gunned down, to be burned alive in cabins like Dorner, Officer Dorner. And what did he do? He stood up on your behalf and he says, these law enforcement, these corporate counsel attorneys, FBI agents, these folks are all preying on you. And everybody rallied around, and there was a shooting here on accident, and a shooting there, and all of this show, and all of this presentation. And what did every sheeple get out of that? They burned him alive in the house. And you don't remember what led up to the FBI having to kill Officer Dorner. And it's the same exact identical situation to what led up to the FBI assassinating Dr. Martin Luther King. He was in and out of jail. They were trying to vilify him. They were criminalizing Dr. King so that the sheeple would turn against him, so that the sheeple would turn against each other. And when they could not vilify him, when they couldn't besmirch his name, what did they do? They had to assassinate him and get rid of him.
Okay, yeah, and again, back to Peaches Geldof. That's her first name, Peaches. What she had done is she outed the Lost Prophets singer, Ian Watkins, the guy that was just recently sentenced to 29 years in prison for child sex abuse.
Right.
You know, the groupies were bringing him their babies and stuff to rape. And, and it was that incident that leads me to suspicion of her death. Because, absolutely, like I said, 25 years old, healthy.
And these false-flag females, they say they're groupies and they say they're the mothers of these children. These are children out of the adoption industry. This is what CAPTA does for you people. The Child Abuse Prevention and Treatment Act. The Child Abuse Prevention, meaning child abuse hasn't occurred yet, by which to steal children off of their mothers and fathers and sell them into the child sex trade industry. If you really look at these media reports, if you really, really look, you'll find that adoptive mothers and fathers are killing their children. You'll find that foster care is killing children, but they're listed as a guardian. They're listed as the, quote, parent. As Congress pits society against itself and each other and kills children in the process, rapes children in the process. And these aren't like 9 years old or 10 years old. These are six-month-old babies that these predators are preying on in order to make them productive in their later years. When a child of those ages are so tiny, so innocent, so fragile, and something grabs a hold of them and preys on them to that extent. They're broken. They grow up to be criminals. They grow up to require the psychiatric industry. They grow up to have these all of these issues, and they can be diagnosed by any number of attorneys through the ICD-10, International Classification of Diseases and Disorders. That's the name of the game. Kill off the parents, take the kids. Steal the kids through gullible and innocent parents. You know, there was an attorney back in the 80s, Lisa Steinberg, Joey Steinberg. Here's an attorney that promised a female that he was going to adopt the child into a loving home, that took the child home with him. Illegally, of course. But this is what attorneys do, just like they prey on those 96-year-old widows. And what did he do to Lisa? He murdered her. And when they went into that home, what did they find? What were you told back in the 80s regarding domestic violence? You were told all of these men are beating on their females. And one of those stories happened to be of Mr. Steinberg, who's out of prison now, by the way. He got 8 years for that murder and beating the hell out of Hedda Nussbaum. Her face was so swollen. Her nose had been broken so many times. She was plastered all over as a face for domestic violence. She was beaten. Lisa was murdered by nobody else other than an attorney. But the world looked on and said, oh, that's a male. No, that's a psychopath. And he has nothing to do with humanity. You need to wake up now and realize what these attorneys are doing before it's too late for you and yours. Now, this 39-year-old woman in Utah, from CNN.com, told police she either strangled or suffocated at least six babies immediately after she gave birth to them over a period of years. How's that for psychopathy? Sick. Sick. This is what you're allowing to be created as you coddle these females. And you coddle these psychopathic doctors. And you coddle these psychopathic attorneys. And you allow them to represent you. Allow them to speak on your behalf while they're out raising others. This is a nutty one from WLSAM.com. It's a report. Doctor charged with firing gun in apartment blames nervous tick. A doctor who had 900 registered guns in his Lincoln Park high-rise fired one into his neighbor's apartment Thursday, telling police it was an accident and a, quote, nervous tick. Quote, everything happened so fast, the 53-year-old Michael Olivieri allegedly told police after his arrest. He said, quote, he had squeezed the trigger, an act that was like a nervous tick, like squeezing a tennis ball, according to the arrest report. Now, this is where it gets weird. Olivieri, who is on leave from work after going deaf, told police he had placed one of his guns on the kitchen island and thought he had replaced his bullets with dummy rounds before he fired from his 14th floor apartment in the 2000 block of Lincoln Park West, according to the report. So he just walks around threatening people with dummy rounds, or is he that stupid to try to make up an excuse? And apparently people are going deaf without cause now. These things are insane. He just went deaf. Crazy. Crazy, crazy, crazy world. And everything's upside down.
See? Yeah, so, yeah, I was trying to comment on the mom that killed the babies.
I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, I just, wanted to elaborate on that. And the attorney work product document, of course, from the IMF to the funding has always been that under feminism, you know, the woman gets everything, you know, and I saw this firsthand in my case. You know, when I tried to patronize the system and go through the proper channels, as I thought, you know, I brought the fact, my children being kidnapped, basically, taken out of state against my wishes, okay, and clean hand doctrine, I put that in there, and a judicial review after they rolled over me the first time. And they just rolled over that, too. I was scratching my head for the longest time, wondering why I'm not getting anywhere in these courts, you know, until you came along and showed me how these things are just commercial courts of law, where people go in there for sale and condemnation to basically offset congressional bankruptcy under 20 EOC 453, and that the cards are stacked against the males because they don't want the male influence on children, because the children will grow up and have, too many qualities that the attorneys don't like and don't consider good product in their commercial units out there, which are persons.
Right. And it all stems from reservation, of course. The Bretton Woods Agreement started this. This is a banking mechanism. Females have been held in chattel since the Coronation Charter, or Charter of Liberties, when that Congress at the time, with the face of a king, came in and said, you know what, I'm going to hold on to all these estates on behalf of all the females, and just in case. Just in case something happens to the males. And what had happened? They killed off all the males, and ever since, females have been chattel. Go to the Bretton Woods Agreements and the establishment of the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, the Emergency Banking Act, and related attorneys taken oath under 12 U.S.C. subsection 73. And they're reserving the rights of females over the male so that the male can buy his rights by court process. And that means that you're going into court and you're purchasing your children from this banker who's holding your children hostage. And that's why the female's rights have been reserved. The male, through since 1933, has held, or 38, sorry, has held the majority of the wealth. And so that's his way, or the way, to redistribute those assets. And if the shoe was on the other foot and women held the majority of the wealth, or females held the majority of the wealth, masculism would be in play. And you're watching this now in Israel and Palestine, using Zionism to redistribute Islamism, and Islamism to redistribute Zionism. And it's the same redistribution across the board with Catholicism and Judaism. Corporatism and individualism. And then again, corporatism is redistributed by environmentalism. So it goes back and forth, and they teach you all these concepts, and you buy into it. Now we can find Walmart, now we can find this one, and then we can find this one. And these attorneys are the ones that not only own the corporation, these attorneys are the ones charging the corporations. These attorneys are the ones making these insurance claims on the corporations. And all of these investors and people who own stock in these corporations have no clue what they're actually doing. This is allowing and enabling human trafficking, genocide against the human populace. As the attorney, Satan, which means your adversary, is tricking everybody out. And again, it's the story of Job. Everybody wakes up at some point in time and says, you know what? All my life I've had this, 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 and this happen. And it seems like it always happens in threes. Well, it does. There's three variants on law: Meta, Soma, and Veda. So you're going to be attacked with a divorce, which is morality, Meta. You're going to be attacked with psychology. Somebody in your family is going to die during this time, Soma. And you're going to be dealing with that and grieving and psychologically diagnosed. And somebody's going to be criminalized, which is Veda. And it goes back and forth. Now they're attacking me with taxes. That goes back to morality. Now they're attacking me with the medical industry. They're killing my mother. That goes back to Soma. Now I got a speeding ticket. Now I got picked up for this and that and this and that. Metasoma Veda. Tammy, it always happens in three variants. It always happens three times at a time. I just can't take this anymore. That's the pressure that they came up with under fourth generation warfare to slowly redistribute the human populace through low intensity conflict. It's not that bad, because they don't want you to crack right away. They need you to produce. One third of the global GDP is in consumption and taxation, Meta. One third is in the medical and psychological industry, as well as death, which is Soma. And one third is in the criminal industry, which is Veda. There are no other forms of production on this planet. This is Congress tricking you out. This is Congress targeting you as a war crime and using you to the fullest extent. From cradle to grave, they wrap the millstone around your neck when you're born. And it's there until your death. Until now. Well, the millstone is shifted, of course, as promised. For all those that harm children, be it better that they have the millstone wrapped around their neck and they be tossed into the sea of commerce. Matthew 18.
Now, I'm concerned now what's going to happen with Billy Joel's daughter. Let's see, she fainted on a New York cabaret stage Saturday. And it's the emergency room doctor concluded that Alexa Ray Joel, who's 28, experienced this thing called vesophageal syncope. I don't know what that means, but A common cause of fainting that is usually harmless and requires no treatment. Joel Rep. Claire McCurry said, according to the Mayo Clinic website, a sudden drop in heart rate and blood pressure that can cause reduced blood flow to the brain, which results in a brief loss of consciousness.
Right.
What concerns me, though, now is the emergency room visit, and they diagnosed her. Okay. So now, how are they going to trick her out? What kind of meds are they going to try to get her on? What kind of crap has she got to look forward to in light of, you know, Peaches Geldof and
Mickey Rooney?
Mickey Rooney, yeah, exactly. And even Justin Bieber, you know, I mean, they're raising these people's estates like never before. And if you got some kind of wealth built up, you're a target to these attorneys.
Right, and to let every musician, singer, all of these folks acting and everything else. The first thing that we were taught, and apparently I've seen this a lot recently of people passing out and fainting, you know, when we were first inquiring all those things, first thing we're taught is never to stand up straight. Bend your knees slightly so you don't pass out, because you're cutting off the blood flow to your brain when you're standing up straight, and you're not allowing the blood to flow through your knees.
It looks like she's already suffered too and been diagnosed in the past, because, it goes on and says she suffered what she called a heartbreak related depression after a breakup with a longtime boyfriend and former bandmate Jimmy Riot in 2010. She was rushed to a New York hospital on December 5, 2009 after swallowing a handful of homeopathic pain pills. Her publicist confirmed at the time the pills were not considered to be life-threatening. So, after media reports suggested that her depression was sparked by a fight with her mother, Christy Brinkley, the former model and ex-husband Billy Joel released a public denial. But yeah, they've already diagnosed her in the past, I guess, so she's already been, man, she's already put in that medical industry box.
Right, and just remember, a lot of these children that are born of variations of possibly not human beings, those missing a frontal lobe eventually evolve into Neanderthal. And so if they're missing the frontal lobe, but they are Cro-Magnon, their children may be born Neanderthal. And so the children are hated by Cro-Magnon because there's no bonding experience. There's nothing there that allows them to bond, no Pitocin production, none of these things. And the ability to communicate is decreased. So the child feels hated throughout their lives, and they don't know how to deal with these things. Everybody needs to realize that if you look at it from a scientific perspective, you'll know that you're never going to be able to make them love you. They don't have that capability. A psychopath doesn't view a human being as a human being. It views it as an object, something to sit on a sofa somewhere and to dress up a room. And it's a story of Genesis, or a biogenesis, away from life, mind, and soul. And in the story of Genesis, of course, what did the Lord God do? He put Adam, which literally means man, and Eve in the garden to dress it up. These psychopaths view you as nothing more than an object. And so once you get out of that situation, if you are human, if you are Neanderthal, go away. Go with other humans, and you'll find such not only the relief that comes with finding others of your own makeup, your own constitution, but once you're away from the psychopath, you are able to finally live. Most of you have never even lived a day in your life. You've always been that object. You've always been seeking the right to be. You've always tried and tried and tried to make them love you. They're not going to love you. They don't have that ability. Don't commit suicide over something so ridiculous. You're not the broken one. They are. They're missing the frontal lobe.
Now, in other news then, the soap opera of the missing flight MH370 goes on and on, or M370. I'm almost thinking that they're putting these stories up one after another just to show you how the media is manipulating you, because somebody knows where that plane is. Absolutely, somebody knows where that plane is. And, you know, I can almost guarantee there's 99.9999% chance it's a production. Heck, they had some guy that was trying to fly around the world or something for his retirement, and they pulled him down in his small plane in Indonesia, I believe. Yet, you know, they can't find a big 777 aircraft when it goes missing. I mean, you know, now they're saying all this time later that the co-pilot made a brief phone call. Didn't they have that information, like, immediately with the technology they have? I don't know. I'm thinking more and more I hear that story and they have no solution. PSYOP of some sort. I really don't know what yet, but, you know, this is the kind of news you get in an empire built on lies.
How many children have been abused since everybody's been looking for that plane? How many pedophiles have gotten away with pedophilia while everybody's out looking for that plane or paying attention to all of these things that don't have anything to do with relativity? How many congressional acts were passed? How many people got raised during this time when everybody's looking elsewhere and being entertained by all of these things? Sick. To all of the agents out there. Oh, did you have one?
Well, you know, also, again, over here on CNN, they're running a story, five things you didn't know about Moses, okay? And I haven't even read through them all yet, but let's see. They're saying, oh my goodness, okay, they're saying Moses was probably Egyptian. Okay, like that even matters, you know.
Don't call attention to the fact that he's a judge.
Moses wasn't anti-slavery.
Don't call attention to that he's a judge. And he was, I mean, he was just so foul. Look at him in Exodus. That means away from God.
So they're kind of outing him here as, you know, not being the great liberator that all the churchianity folks want to espouse, but let's see, Moses had a black wife, okay, like that would even matter, like it should even matter, right. Moses didn't come up with a single law. Now they're twisting a lot, I think, because he was a judge.
Absolutely.
He came down and says, I'm bringing you to law so you guys don't kill each other, I'm here to help you, but you know, it's gonna have to be
pay me tax.
Cash only here, yep. Some gold, and I'll take care of you here and make sure you don't kill each other.
Yep.
Moses didn't write the Torah. Okay, well.
Well, absolutely not. That was, back then it would have been the Senate member, Senate of Nicaea, Council of Nicaea. You've got the same Council on Foreign Relations now. It's the same thing. It's the same exact thing.
Yeah, but they're not coming up with, Moses was a judge or anything.
No,
so they're just, it shows you more about the CNN media news spin on things.
BBG.gov. And of course, Moses never talked about who is killing you and stealing your wives and asses. And everybody knows now that that is the attorney. That's how they make money. They do these things for you, guarantee insurance, and then all of a sudden you find yourself in court in front of Moses, and the attorney is there to represent you if you pay him. And it's perpetual. Do you want to be perpetually dead? 1 Corinthians 6, how dare you go in front of them? You can only fornicate by giving it your body. Stop doing those things. Now, they're nailing agents left and right now. MojaveDailyNews.com, detective found dead in jail. Now, we were talking about feminism earlier and how you were terrorized. This one says a veteran Phoenix police detective who was shot by his wife during a domestic violence situation, then arrested on assault and kidnapping charges, was found dead at the Maricopa County Jail on Saturday. Aw, the witness died. Isn't this such a relative experience for everybody going through this kind of crap? And of course, this is Maricopa. This is where the CIA dances around and he pretends to be for the people, for the humanity, when he's getting paid under the table and cutting services to the prisoners and doing all of these shameful things. Maricopa County Sheriff's Office spokesman Paul Chagolia said officials suspected that Billy Souza committed suicide but were further investigating the death after being released from St. Joseph's Hospital in December. So he's all better now after the shooting, right? Souza was taken into custody and booked on two counts of aggravated assault and one count of kidnapping. Pamela Souza told police that she shot her 53-year-old husband in self-defense. Well, of course, she's the chattel. She's the chattel. So we got to get rid of that male that can protect her. We have to specialize the chattel under Hearts and Minds, or Winning Hearts and Minds faction of low-intensity conflict. Because if we don't, and the male held on to everything, and the male took care of females, there could be no predation of attorneys. There would be no taxation if the male was self-governing. There would be no Congress or your transgressor if you guys were protecting your own houses and taking care of your own affairs and not calling law enforcement or 911 when you don't feel like parenting. And we've seen that how many times this year? Where somebody calls in, oh, my kid stole my truck. And they came out, that was in Arizona as well. They came out and a poor father called 911 and said that his child had stolen his truck. And the cops came out and shot the child to death. But daddy got his truck back. This is Nazi Germany. That child was informed on. Over a thing with wheels. From IdahoStatesman.com update, court hearing scheduled Monday in halted DBSI trial, March 21st. This was a couple weeks ago. This one was interesting, and I'll start reading. A hearing has been scheduled Monday in the halted DBSI trial, fraud trial. But court officials wouldn't say Friday whether the hearing will be open to the public. I don't know at this time whether it's going to be sealed, closed, or open, said Kirsten Wilkinson, Chief Deputy of Operations for U.S. District Court. Now, operations, of course, is CIA production. Prosecution and defense attorneys met with Chief District Judge B. Lynn Windmill on Friday morning. The meeting was not listed in the court calendar and did not appear in the online case file. Well, why not? They're not even maintaining court record. The meeting was, Wilkinson declined to explain the legal justification for holding the private meeting without an opportunity for the public to attend. The revised schedule comes after the death of an FBI agent who investigated officials from Meridian-based Diversified Business Services and Investments. That's a function of the court. Let me repeat that. Meridian-based Diversified Business Services and Investments is a function of the court. So this FBI agent realized what the court was doing, which, of course, it's defined as a bank in Black's Law Dictionary. And now he's dead. Now, that's the first agent so far that we've come across that hasn't been acting as to the federal mandate. Now, to all agents out there, if you are innocent, get a hold of us. Because it's coming down, and they are now, and they have been, indemnifying all law enforcement, all FBI agents, all CIA agents. Now, this says there's an operative directing this case, which is CIA. So, of course, that would be a handler. Do not allow your handlers to kill you. Now, the story of Judas in the Bible. Judas means with law in Anglo-Saxon. That means that Judas is the one with law, such as law enforcement, FBI. Now, when you realize that these criminal activities are going on, do not speak your intent. Do not go to them and tell them you know they are criminal. Bring it to our court, the United States court, and I will take the brunt. I am the clerk of the courts, and in that position, they can sue me. They can do whatever they want to me. But do not speak your intent. Time after time after time, my sister Nancy Schaefer was murdered. She's a former U.S. Senator out of Georgia. Charles Lindbergh stood on the House floor and said, "You guys are all corrupt." And this is in 1917. And he pointed out J.P. Morgan, which is a law firm. It wasn't a bank back then. It was a law firm first. And right after that, what happened? Charles Lindbergh's son was murdered for him to get him to shut up. And it was the same thing with McFadden. They tried three times to kill McFadden and finally succeeded. Now in Matthew 27, at the crucifixion of Christ, Judas tries to hand back the silver, which is your paycheck. Judas tried to say, "No, I don't want to work for a criminal enterprise." And he didn't slit his wrists. He committed political suicide. At the point in time when he spoke his intent and said, "I know that you chief priests and you elders are a criminal enterprise," he committed political suicide. They took him out. They called him a pedophile. They called him a child abuser. They pulled Violence Against Women Act against him and said he was an aggressor under the domestic violence laws. That's how Judas commits political suicide. Do not speak your intent. Do not tell them that you're going to indict them. You are law enforcement. The United States court only adheres to public law, which means do no harm. If you are adhering to public law, you are my law enforcement. Now the bond is out there. If you'd like to contact me at tammyk23@hotmail.com, or you can call me at 501-584-8459. I will take the brunt. I want you to be safe. Right now, Congress, through the Southern Poverty Law Center, which is made up of attorneys, which was evidenced to be a domestic terror cell in federal court, is vilifying both law enforcement and citizens alike, attempting to pit them and polarize them, identical to what they did during the Civil War last time. This is a means of cutting overhead. Getting rid of you and getting rid of us. Now enough is enough. And of course I got another 404 error from HamptonRoads.com. This is Virginia. Virginia Beach lawyer charged with defrauding clients. Norfolk, Virginia Beach attorney has been charged in federal court with misappropriating more than $2 million in client money. David R. Flynn, 44, of Norfolk, has already had his law license suspended and is facing a civil lawsuit over the same allegations. Flynn faces one count of mail fraud and one count of unlawful monetary transactions. Quote, the U.S. attorney's office filed the charges Friday in U.S. District Court. Flynn is accused of misappropriating $2.3 million from real estate escrow accounts last year. Okay, now there's a lot more going on here behind the scenes, such as the IOLTA trust, the interest on attorney trust accounts, on lawyer trust accounts, IOLTA. And what they're doing is they're hiding this money. So, for example, when you are sued, somebody brings you into court and sues you, the minute an attorney appears on your behalf, that is called a cognitive judgment. They've already solidified that judgment against you. And the insurance already paid out. And the attorney puts it in that aisle to trust. Now, over the next 4, 8, 12, or 16 years, you're going to be duking it out in court with the court jesters playing this game. And eventually, through the Devonshire Participation Program, you will walk away with 0.82% of all of it. While the attorneys and the attorney in black dress fee splits or fee shares all of those monies for you. And they're earning interest on those accounts. And because it's in a trust, it's not touched by taxes. Now let that sink in. This is Nazi Germany. You're being raised. It looks really pretty because you have a jester up there without the little bells on his shoes, without the little bells on his hat. He's in an Armani suit and he drives a nice car. And there's another attorney with a big black dress on, holding a hammer, and sitting up there behind a big bench. And he looks important. And it's all a presentation by which to redistribute your assets into their pockets. And the same presentation is called a hospital, nursing home, assisted living center, juvenile justice hall, prison, yada yada. It's a corporation. This is how the corporation makes money.
So I wonder if it's anything to do with that blood moon that's going down now, I guess.
Oh, I can't see anything about weather. It's just horrifying here.
Can't see this guy from here, but they got it on the internet. You can watch the blood moon. It'll turn copper red for just more than an hour.
Yeah.
As part of a lunar eclipse.
And I wanted to see that so bad because...
And if cloud cover cooperates in your area, I guess.
Because of Revelation 6 and Revelation 6:12. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell onto the earth, even as a fig tree casts her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. Now, of course, when you go back to the tree of knowledge, it stems from the word fig, which is fide, fiduciary. Revelation 6:14, and the heaven departed as a scroll when it rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places, and the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? Now remember, in 1453, Constantinople fell during the blood moon as well. And when you look at sackcloth, that word is what a clergy wears. I am your clerk. I am your tongue. And I give my life for you. And no matter what, we will get through this, and Satan, the attorney, will be held accountable. Your God.
Yeah, and there's not such a good thing as a good attorney, you know. R.E. Stuart Rhodes.
Yeah, there's one in Alaska saying that he's a good attorney, too.
Yeah, they're all good attorneys when it comes to being good at... hypothecating you, throwing you under the bus to offset congressional bankruptcy.
Absolutely. That good attorney.
That's all it means.
Yeah.
And then we have all these people, all these patriots, patronizing Stuart Rhodes, who's an attorney.
Here's one from KETV.com. Iowa County attorney found dead. Authorities made the discovery Friday morning. Centerville, Iowa. Authorities say a county attorney found dead in his southern Iowa home died of natural causes. The Appanoose County Sheriff's Office says 40-year-old Richard F. Scott was found deceased Friday morning inside his Centerville home. An investigation by local authorities and the county medical examiner's office determined the cause of death, period. Centerville police sent officers to the home after Scott did not show up for court proceedings as Appanoose County attorney. Now, this is one of the most weirdest media releases ever, of course. 40-year-old attorney dies of natural causes. And then the statement, I mean, that was the end of the story. The statement says an investigation by local authorities and the county medical examiner's office determined the cause of death, period. It doesn't say how he died other than natural causes, but it's just... This is profound. He was 40 years old.
Yeah, people just die of natural causes when they're 40 years old or too old.
Yeah, it was because he was 40, according to the news report.
Now, Stuart Rhodes guy, these guys are dangerous. And these patients just get sucked right into this constitutional theory nonsense. You know, read the Commerce Clause and get your mind wrapped around the Commerce Clause and how it ties into you being pledged for the debt, and you'll see what I'm talking about. But he's the founder of Oath Keepers.
Oh yeah, that's the CIA presentation. That attorney is just a CIA presentation. And anybody who wants to study this, it's the quickest way is reading the book 4 of the Church Committee reports, supplementary detailed staff reports on foreign and military intelligence. And it talks about the CIA product, who the actors are. You can even find out in there, it's written, who killed JFK, of course. And but nobody wants to read for a long, long, long time. And I read it. You can find that on Bono's Entertainment or at YouTube, Foreign and Military Intelligence, Part 1 and 2.
And just to clarify, Church was a guy's name. It doesn't have anything to do with the...
Religious sect.
Religious
no.
sect.
No, it was the Church Committee reports, and then you've got other committees that have been formulated to study all of these things, and more money goes into attorney pockets to find out that, oh my goodness, the FBI assassinated JFK. The FBI already knew that. It was at the behest of the F, or the federal government, the Confederacy itself. But this is another means of raising humanity, is to kill people and then study why the people were killed by themselves and each other.
Yeah, you people out there are being played like a fiddle by these merchants in bright, shiny clothes, wearing the constitutional flag and whatnot, appearing on Alex Jones' show, for God's sakes.
Right, and Alex is human. We didn't find that out until after Nancy was murdered. You know, we had given him all of the evidence and everything else of the house case that went all the way up to Rick Perry. Rick Perry's traded on Dun & Bradstreet as the general counsel and the Department of Health and Human Services, which of course stems from Henry Kissinger's depopulation program. 1975, he established the Office of Population Affairs, which is opa.gov. Anybody can go there right now, opa.gov, and find that is the Department of Health and Human Services. That's a depopulation program. And everybody who wants to cry out about the NSA spying on you, stop applying for benefits. You are giving them all of your information. They don't have to expend any dollars on the NSA spying on you. You are the informant. How much do you make? Okay, what kind of assets do you have? The census? You fill out these Delphi surveys all the time. Publishers Clearinghouse. Do you think you're going to win any money, or do you think they're raising you? Fill this out. What kind of products do you buy? What kind of household income do you have? How many kids are living in that home? How much more detail do you have to go into to realize that you are your own national security agent?
When you buy into this patriotism and constitutional theory being promoted by people like Oath Keepers. What is Oath Keepers promoting? They're promoting to uphold the Constitution, okay, which includes that Commerce Clause, which includes, you know, all the derivatives off that they built up through, you know, one long congressional play of all these congressional actions get you into going along with the Judiciary Act from 1789, allowed for these courts of condemnation to be created in the first place. They're places of business, right out of the Judiciary Act that people like Rye Class will tell you, you know, such a good thing, and this is what we're under, you know, and they put themselves in that box themselves and drag you along in there with them. So the moral of the story is by playing into that Oath Keepers facade, you're facilitating congressional bankruptcy being offset to your own demise.
Right, and anybody who wants to study that, go to 28 USC, which is the judiciary. And it says everything in there. But if you really want the meats and potatoes, go to the Banking Act, because the attorney oath is 12 USC subsection 73. Pledging an oath that they're not hypothecated, but that humanity is. And when you go to your state statutes, administrative code, what's a surety? Only a natural person can be a surety. Now, a person, it's not natural, a person, capital P, is a corporation. A natural person would be a human being as a franchise, created as a legal name upon their docking here in that place called the United States of America, which was never a geographical state. It's a style or chain of events. If you read Article 1 of the Articles of Confederation, Articles are articles of incorporation. These are business documents. This is incorporating a corporation with the Articles of Confederation, with the Articles of the Constitution, which actually ended. That was a contract with the Treasury to take care of humanity. Article 1 through Article 1, Section 9, Clause 3. No bill of attainder or ex post facto law shall be passed. That means that's the end of the document. Congress, of course, came in and added to it a little bit more with the Articles of Confederation. Article 12, it says you're pledged and charged to discharge its bankruptcy. Thank you very much, plebeian. Now it's time to push back. It's time to stand and be resurrected. Of course, Jesus, the word G-E, space S-U-I-S, means your earth in Greek and Latin. You're the one that's hanging on the cross. Who put you there? Congress. What does Congress mean? Con means with. Gress means with transgression. And what are you taught in their manifest? Forgive your transgressor. Hell no. If you are caught and you are evidenced to be human trafficking and perpetrating genocide, you will be held accountable. That's what we're here for. These things are just absolutely foul. If anybody wants to know more about the lunar eclipse in 1453, it was May 20th, Thursday, April 5th until Tuesday, May 29th, was the siege of Constantinople.
Is that going back with our current calendar? Because no. They've changed the calendar since then.
Right. This was based on the Julian calendar, and the partial eclipse occurred on May 22nd, 1453, but according to the Julian calendar. So if anybody wants to study that, it's a really neat study as well. And we're seeing more crap in Canada again. From the Mississauga.com, charges dropped against Brampton real estate agent. And this was really interesting to read as well. Theft charges against a Bramston real estate agent have been dropped. The Crown withdrew the two break and enter and theft charges against Shalinder Kapoor, 39, April 7th, in a Milton court almost a year after the charges were laid. Now Kapoor is fighting to regain his reputation and his real estate license. Quote, I lost my identity, my prestige, my income, I lost everything, end quote, Kapoor said. He said the Real Estate Council of Ontario, RECO, recalled, that's funny, suspended his license soon after the charges were laid. He applied last week to have the license reinstated. Kapoor said the two charges were dropped by the Crown because there was no reasonable prospect of a conviction. But he's still trying to find out exactly how he wound up accused of two crimes he did not commit. Now this very last line. He was charged by Halton Regional Police last May, accused of taking as much as $40,000 worth of jewelry from a home for sale in Milton. Period. He was later charged with a similar offense for a theft reported in March. Now again, going back to guarantee insurance, just recently a real estate agent happened to find that lady who committed suicide out in New Jersey. She was going to be evicted the next day, of course, when he happened to find her. Everybody needs to realize who's the actor and who are these military enforcements on the ground. Of course, you know, Joseph Reynolds was murdered by the medical industry in court process. And we watched that play out from start to finish. The attorney gets him into the hospital. The attorney takes guardianship. The attorney takes executorship, conservatorship over this male that's about to die. And then all of a sudden the house is up for sale. And it's held by Coldwell Banker. And doesn't that sound familiar? As Coldwell Banker is the representation to the court, which is the actual bank. Everybody needs to realize who's who in this game. Ephesians 6, because your war is not with humanity. Your war is with principalities and principal agents. These things are so sad, and so sad that they'd be going on this long before it stopped. You know, it's horrifying. And every day we're watching this just turned upside down. So sad. We're coming up on the 2 hour mark. Do you want to go for a third or?
I don't know. What do our listeners want? I don't know.
I'm scared to check and see if there is any listeners. Maybe we're just talking to ourselves tonight.
Yeah. The, media presentations out there that got everybody's ear, or like, We Are Change, you know, I mean, We Are Change, Lou Rudowski, he just interviewed Stuart Rhodes. You wonder why these guys got such good media production and all these viewers, and they're supposedly operating on a shoestring budget, and of course they're promoting the constitutional right stuff. If you really want to see who the snake oil salesmen are, that are the alternative snake oil salesmen, I guess, ask yourself, who's not outing the attorneys? Who's not outing Congress? Who's promoting this constitutional theory, which allows for a republic or democracy, depending on market conditions, which are you, the product? Who's promoting all this human trafficking?
And who's
Are these guys really serving your best interests?
And who's paying them to advertise for their product?
How do they have money to go travel around and cover these things, at the Bundy Ranch, etc.?
Well, you know how they make an attorney get a license to practice law because it's a proprietary system. Only attorneys can practice the law with a patent on it. Okay? So when you have a bunch of CIA advertisers up there selling you constitutional theory and United States code and everything else, they have to be paid for advertising that product, don't they?
Right.
Okay, so when years ago Walter Burian found almost 800,000 state employees.
That was in 2008 or 2009. That was like 5-6 years ago.
Right. Well, at that time, there was almost 800,000 employees.
Yeah, what is it now?
I don't know, but but it's quite funny because we couldn't...
Probably how they keep the unemployment rate down is by throwing those figures in.
Right. Well, we couldn't find where the money was coming from until years later, of course. And there was these departments, there were, you know, checks going out each month, but without titles and without all of these things. And it wasn't until I experienced myself several of these cases, and these females were being put on disability, municipal disability accounts through the municipalities. And that's where those monies were coming from. These females were paid agents, but it appeared like they were disabled in some way. And how they were getting that was being granted that by the Lord God, which is a judge sitting up there. And one of the most egregious, she was diagnosed 5 times as a psychopath. And this is during the child custody case. Children are diagnosed as sexually abused. She's the one with STD. The children have STD given to them by mom. And mom's working for the prosecuting attorney's office on a probationary term, right? So the first 90 days... she goes off on a disability from the prosecuting attorney's office. Now, the last time I looked at that case, she was still on disability from a position she never had. This is how they're funneling those monies to pay these agents to rape and molest children, to be human agents. They are on municipal disabilities. They're not on SSI. They're not on SSD. They're not on veterans pay. They're not on retirement pay. That job that she took up right at the cusp of a child custody case was on a probationary experience. She was on probation for 90 days, and she didn't cut the 90 days. She didn't make the probation time. But she went on disability at that point. So those monies, they come out of nowhere, created by that judge and the prosecuting attorney and the experts and the GAL involved in that case, which is Marianne Schaap, by the way, Wisconsin. And these child sexual predators are paying mom rent on the children. Mom doesn't give a care. She's on a mental health disability and gets lots of feel-good drugs. Ativan, Seroquel, everything to make her all sleepy, calm. Better than pot because it's legal, right? Better than alcohol. She doesn't have hangovers. She can take another pill. One pill to put her down, one pill to take her up. One pill for the kid. The kid's diagnosed with what? ADHD and all of this stuff. So the kid gets pseudo cocaine. Guess who's taking that stuff? So mom's got downers, Seroquel, Ativan, all of these anti-anxiety meds, and uppers, cocaine derivatives. This is what you're patronizing, folks. The raising of you and your communities through these little secret agents that you don't know exist. You're marrying these agents. And Bo had to learn that the hard way. Well, he's went right to work in the Attorney General's office as the legal assistant for the Attorney General. And when we brought up that she was human trafficking and they were complicit in these things, they cut her from that position and put her sideways in another position in the same corporation. But from the average viewer, it looks like she's just in a different form of employment now. No, she's not. Same corporation. This is what they do day after day after day after day to abuse children and to leave them only with the psychopath so that these predators can get at them. And I'm here to say, I'm coming. don't wait for me to show you some sign that I'm coming. Because in just a moment, I'm going to take your legs out from underneath of you, and you are going to lose everything you've ever had, everything you've ever known, because you chose to human traffic children, to perpetrate the most horrifying crimes against humanity, including genocide, which you have been found guilty of. And no one, absolutely no one, will be spared.
Yeah, there's no statute of limitations under the public law. That's attorney work product doctrine there. You know, they just invented some crazy statute to say, well, the evidence is too old, it's no good anymore, we can't do anything about it.
Right.
That ain't happening under the public law. Update on the Bundy farm. Just getting from the Friends of the These Changing Times group here, from Snowhawk. Sheriff Richard Mack tells Ben Swan, sources inside BLM and Las Vegas Metro say no questions. Feds are preparing for a raid on the Bundy home. This includes Bundy Children's Home as well. Okay. Now, Richard Mack is a constitutional attorney, all right? Or, I'm sorry, he's a sheriff, constitutional sheriff. Now, as I said in the video that I did the other night, we don't need constitutional sheriffs. And as I pointed out last hour, towards the end, that this whole idea of constitutionalism is selling you back down the road of human trafficking.
Right, a constitutional sheriff is protecting the constitutional person created by the 14th Amendment.
Okay, so he just loves this controversy, I'm sure, or his handlers do. I don't know. I don't like constitutional sheriffs. I like sheriffs that adhere to public law, which so far isn't very many of them. Now, and the ones that do, like that fella down in Tennessee, you know, then they get victimized by the judge that he arrested. Like, for example, the judge and a clerk he arrested, now he's being charged for $5 million. He's driving around in his own beat-up old Ford Mustang, and it's down to one sheriff deputy or something because of
domestic terrorism.
Domestic terrorism by these
attorneys.
Yeah, attorneys in black dresses are called judges by title only, not by the evidence. But anyway, so telling Ben Swan. Ben Swan is another big patriot guru or whatever out there, I guess. But let's see. Just see what it says here. Hundreds of federal agents are still at the Bundy Ranch, and the area continues its status as a no-fly zone. It's a war zone. It's a war zone out there. And, let's see, despite major media reports that the Nevada Bureau of Land Management is retreating, the remaining activity that still surrounds the ranch illustrates a different scenario. Not only is BLM not actually backing off the Clive and Bundy Sheriff Richard Mack of the Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers Association has revealed stunning information on Ben Swan's radio program. Mack said that he has received intelligence from multiple credible sources inside the BLM and the Las Vegas Metro that there is no question that the federal government is planning a raid on the Bundy home and the homes of their children who live on the property. Okay? According to Mack, the so-called retreat was nothing more than theatrics. And it's all theatrics between the federal state and the national state. And they're selling this idea of constitutional theory and patriotism. You know, so there's actually three factions going on there. And they're all against humanity. The
right.
Feds, the nationalists, and the patriots. They are all selling you down the wrong road. What you want to do is hold them accountable for human trafficking. How can they take their land when they're a corporation? Corporations are fictions. Fictions can't own anything. But the attorney work product doctrine says, no, fictions can own stuff. Sure they can. People are bad. Look at all this controversy over here. They're bad. Letting those cows run around on the turtles' land, stomping on turtles. I don't know. Your input on this story?
Well, when you look at the concept of the raising, the Reclamation Acts, yesterday and the day before and the day before, everybody's screaming out for John McCain, come and save us, Harry Reid, sitting on the Senate Judiciary Committee, all of these people that are on the Senate Intelligence Committee. John McCain is the lord of the Reclamation Acts. When you go look at his congressional actions, he's been reclaiming things for the federal state that are just absolutely ridiculous on their faces. But of course, the Gelnhausen Charter says people don't care. Sheeple do not care. We can do anything we want to, and in 5 minutes, they're going to forget what we did and go on to the next thing. They're going to be farming on Facebook and posting how bored they are and playing on YouTube or whatever else, listening to somebody else. And this is how they get away with this stuff. They promote these presentations. Sheriff Mack is not really a sheriff. A constitutional sheriff, according to the 14th Amendment, which created the corporation as a living being, maintains corporate policy. A sheriff, on the other hand, that's adherent to the public law, is a steward of mankind. Sheriff protects humanity. It doesn't protect corporations.
Isn't that evidence that they're still calling Richard Mack Sheriff Mack? These sheriffs are sheriff only by title? I mean, he's still holding on to that title even though he's not a sheriff anymore.
Absolutely. And it's all based on their pledges. I mean, here they are. They're in bed with each other. Look at what corporate policy actually does. Now, they trick out females under VAWA. They trick out children under CACA, Crimes Against Children Act, and Violence Against Women Act. These corporations are maintained on corporate welfare based on all of these codes and statutes. So, when there's a constitutional sheriff or an FBI agent or a CIA agent, which is the military on behalf of Congress, you have who protecting who. If a sheriff knows that there are predators, if a sheriff knows that there are predators in an area and they're protecting the predators, that means the sheriff is not a sheriff. It means the sheriff is a predator. It's a pedophile. And it's maintaining, as a military force, corporate policy by which to take your kids off of you as a sheriff. Of course, that's the one at your door with CPS, right? And it takes your elderly family members off of you, sheriff at the door with adult protection. And you've seen this come down in the last 2 months. Attorneys are raping elderly people in nursing homes that are too weak to fight back. Doctors raping the elderly that are too weak to fight back. This is what those constitutional sheriffs are protecting, because they have an oath to the corporation. Now, what is the 1947 National Security Act? It revamped the military and law enforcement toward national security. State security refers to humanity. National security refers to the corporation, a new life, a new body. Everybody needs to get their heads out of their rectums and realize who's preying on you and who's who. Why they're doing this. You've got a call coming through. I don't know if I can pick it up. Let me see if you can hear it. Let me know if you can hear it. It's one of the listeners calling in. Hi, Chris. This is Tami. You're on the air. We've got Bo right here.
Oh, is this Tami?
Yep.
Hi, Tami. This is Christopher.
Hi, how are you?
I am very well. I'm in San Jose, California.
How's everything going out there?
Come again?
How's everything going out there?
Well, as good as it can be out here in California. It's pretty heavenly, besides the mess the corporations got us in out here.
Absolutely. I mean, it's worse out there because it's more heavily populated. Therefore, you have more representation by which to raise you. How many attorneys are out there? It's god-awful. It's almost as bad as Chicago now.
Yeah, San Francisco is plagued with them all over the place. And we're a bit challenged. But I was reading your motion to void ab initio on your website.
Oh, that's a, it's not void ab initio, it goes back to the beginning.
Right. That's what it means.
Right, like void the order from the beginning, right?
Right.
I was concerned that if I was to use this, I wouldn't necessarily know how to put it in the right form so that, it would be recognized in a court.
Well, you only use that if you're the one that initiated the case in the first place. You only use that if you initiated the case. If somebody brought a case against you that's based on fraudulent language or conduct, you'd want to use the equitable estoppel.
Right. Yeah, I think I understand that now. If I brought the case.
Right. And if you brought the case, you want to use admission statements, of course. And at the inception, if you asked that judge to do something for you, then it should have done that, correct? Unless it played attorney work product doctrine, which of course is probably what you're dealing with now and the reason that you're calling. But the void ab initio brings it back to the very beginning and says, no, we're going to stop this at the first fraud. And that's the attorney's action after that point in time. And so it brings it all the way back, and it forces a judge to be there. And, of course, we've evidenced throughout time that there are no judges, there are only attorneys. But you have to at least ask the judge if there's a judge there by maintaining admissions on court record, which is admissions of evidence. A judge can only view evidence and rule accordingly. If it's practicing law, it's not a judge, it's an attorney in a black dress, and of course there is no immunity for attorneys in black dresses or otherwise, because they're practicing under acts of commerce and private acts.
Right. Well, my challenge has been with a certain judge that wouldn't recognize my processes that I was
of course
using
not.
There, and he's discontented that I wasn't willing to let him, he felt I was trying to control his courtroom. He was a little upset about that.
Right.
And, I've been trying to figure out how to come out after this and settle this little debt that I have for the court system regarding a case in 2009 that I was...
What was the case about?
Into. Again?
What was the case about?
I had borrowed a vehicle, and I wasn't able to get the vehicle back on time, and the presumption was there that the vehicle was stolen, and so
did you harm a human being?
I was brought in on that, and then later the registered owner of the vehicle decided that they didn't want me to be charged. With it, but
Right. So they're protecting both of you as infants under acts of commerce and private acts. Those are commercial crimes. Did you ever harm a human being?
No, I don't have the nature.
So if you've never harmed a human being, those charges against you and the actions against the registered owner or whatever, they're protecting that as an infant as well. So there's charges and a lien against that estate. You need to go ahead and indict them for maintaining those liens on you.
Yeah, or indict them any time that you have evidence where, you know, the judge, quote unquote, has represented you, acting as an attorney on your behalf instead of a judge. Anytime the district attorney comes along, he picks up the charges, even though the original guy dropped them. That's executor days on tort.
Right, and he's acting.
You know, yeah, write all this stuff in an indictment, lay it down. Of course, the DA and the sheriff, they'll just, as they did in my case, they'll just ignore it. So then you wait your 30 days and send it all into the House of Lords. That's their bosses.
And as well as the United States Court.
Well, I feel that's probably a pretty solid process if I could understand how to do it all correctly and not get myself in a tizzy with them, because they've already done a lot of damage and they've accepted corporation accepted my fee schedule, like they did with Rocco, of course, and
right.
You know, I just haven't been able to do any enforcement.
Okay, so if you have your docs already on, you have your F&E docs done?
yeah, I have them in my computer, but I haven't done any recording other than in my own private manner role.
Of course, it's harder than the Dickens to get anything recorded anywhere in California, it seems. They don't want you putting anything on there without a notary and such.
Yeah, that's been my little stumbling block there. I was having an idea that I might go to do a recording in New Mexico or something.
Right. It's easier over there, and we had several that went to, you know, Arizona, New Mexico. We don't want to hurt anybody or cause them any financial harm, but you do need to get those recorded, because once those are recorded, the F&E docs and your fee schedule ordinance of the estates and everything, once that's done, then you can just bring it through our court, because then that tells me that you're not a citizen of the United States Incorporated or the United States of America, and that allows me to be your clerk. And that allows our judges now, that it allows the court to be your court. And so once our judge gets that evidence, then, of course, he's a judge. He acts on the evidence only, and everything will fall through from that point in time. But the court cannot parent anybody who's a child of another state or another, quote, country. So if you're patronizing another country, then the court doesn't have any jurisdiction over you unless I pick you up as an infant, which I can do, but I don't really want to treat anybody like infants. I want everybody in their own house. Everybody needs to be patronizing their own house. When this falls and the court, I don't want to be the clerk forever. I don't want to be a court. I don't want a court to even be in your way. There should be no existence of law. There should be no existence of clerks. There should be no existence of all of these things. And the only way to fight them was to come in as a court, to condemn their court, to let them abuse us maliciously and evidence their work so that we could facilitate the United States court. But I don't want it to be here forever. I want everybody in their own houses. I want everybody patronizing their own houses and upholding the public law. And then law enforcement upholding the public law instead of corporate policy. Nobody should be cashing in on what happens to you. That's prostitution. If somebody's charging for the use of your body, that's prostitution. If a judge is getting paid by a pedophile to rape kids, that's prostitution. Right. And that should not exist in any relative state.
Now, I encourage people to read, you know, my case, which is really our case, because I came in as the United States in rem, and from start to finish, you know, the House of Lords, the one I sent to the House of Lords, has all the nuts and bolts in that. Now, you have to kind of read it in reverse order the way we sent it in. We went most recent to Foundation. But that was, we did that about as perfect as we could, with the exception I did spell Kissinger wrong. But yeah. they know who I'm talking about. It's only one Henry Kissinger. But, you know, all the little subtle things on when we switched the header caption, okay? Just that little line at the bottom.
Recaptioning.
Yeah, well, we recaptioned it. We did that for, you know, in a very specific timeline. When we had the evidence that they had abjured the realm.
Right. And that they had brought forth a second distress after being notified of the first. Okay, so now they're compounding a crime, and they're evidencing as we went along the maintenance and the creation and maintenance of the criminal enterprise itself. And so we just laid over. We said, okay, do you know that you're doing this? And they said, yep, and they did it. And then we'd say, okay, do you know that you're doing this? Do you know this law? You know, you're violating this law. And you're doing these things. Do you know that you're doing these things? They said, yep, and they went ahead and do it. And each time we were able to evidence the criminal enterprise throughout the case. And by August, they had condemned the federal court as a criminal enterprise. And by the middle of August, they were all declared dead based on 38 U.S.C. subsection 108. They're all civilly dead because they are felons. And that allowed the attachment on their estates. It allowed the facilitation of the writ of fiero fasces debonis ecclesiasticus, which is a seizure on their clerical goods. So then we went along and we had to follow through and cross all of our T's and dot the I's. And here's the next one was the kidnapping and then the genocide. And, you know, we had to follow all of that through in order for the United States to have standing, to be standing. We had to evidence first that they were criminal enterprise and then, of course, finding them guilty based on the evidence, you know, and then, you know, we just followed it all the way through. And here we are now, and they are being held accountable for genocide. And
we're dealing with it now on the insurance level.
Right. And the foreclosure is coming, and that's those are the rules. Sorry.
Right, so the interest in their property will revert to
humanity.
Through your court to
humanity.
General welfare, how does that work?
Absolutely. The 10% of the assets and revenue go to law enforcement. Law enforcement administrative. They get $6,000 lawful dollars each month, which, of course, is right now a market value of gold. It's like a million something.
A million?
Yeah, what is it? It's 6,000 ounces of gold is
well, I don't know. It's about what? $1,500 an ounce? Yeah. I'm not sure. I haven't looked at it.
Whatever that is. That's what the contract is with law enforcement, as well as there's a $250,000 FRN bounty on attorneys that the attorneys get, or that the sheriff gets to keep for themselves, because of course that's blood money. It can't go back into the treasury, and it's the same thing that they had done with Judas. So we just facilitated everything in reverse, and now of course it's in our court as per the rules of the exchequer, as per ecclesiastical law, Westminster. You know, they were collecting on you, calling you bankrupt, when the majority of you were never bankrupt. You're not criminal. You've never hurt anybody. You've never harmed anybody. And so you can't be listed as depraved. You've never committed a felony. Now, they were holding you as chattel because they said you had abjured the realm. Well, how did they do that? They tricked your mother into informing you as a fiction. And so now everybody needs to back out of being that fiction, being the description, and be relative with each other. Realize what you are. If you go all the way back to Genesis 1, 2, 3, 4, you realize that, you know, you're God. They were teaching you, God, that you were not, so that they can own you and trick you out and use your body. And Jesus explains this in the New Testament, and of course Revelation is your walk. This is when they're revealed and you're revealed.
Now, I'm glad you brought up the general welfare clause, because yes, that is a big part of our case as well. And in just today, over in CNN, in the opinion section, they ran a story, what if government guaranteed you an income? So they're testing the waters here to see how people are going to react to this, you know, and it's in our case, so we gave them 2 years to deprogram the people. Here it is in the media. They're starting to break the ice on this. So this is coming down the pike now, and this is the reason why we're doing the radio shows at this point, is to get people on board with what is actually occurring behind the scenes.
Well, I've been listening to pretty much everything you put out there on YouTube and on the calls and whatnot. And I have a few other folks that are diligently trying to comprehend it as well. So.
And that's what we need. It's a requirement for all of us to be humanity. They had separated us and called us all different things, you know, colors and genders and everything you can imagine from that tree of knowledge. And it's all about humanity. They came in and interceded in life itself. And now it's time to get rid of those attorneys and Satan. That's what the attorney is. It's your adversary.
The ones that tell you that turtles and cows just can't get along on their own. You got to have attorneys in there to protect them.
Yeah.
Well, you know, they might step on them, right?
Yeah, and it's ridiculous because the cows avoid those turtles. They've got a symbiotic relationship going on there in the environment, actually.
Always.
Well, doesn't that kind of the claim over the creatures, doesn't that go back to the Vatican?
No, that was the Forest and Chase's charter.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah, and this...
The glossary actually was built over 800 years or so?
Right, and it's based on commerce and navigation. So when you go back to the East Indian Trading Corporation, the British East Indian Trading Corporation, look at that flag. It's the United States flag all over again. It's the same thing. It's the same Department of Transportation, except for it was called shipping back then. It was called commerce and navigation. And when you go back into their original dictionaries of commerce and navigation, you'll find the congressional acts. Those are not like dictionaries that you're used to with word after word and definition after definition. Those are the record of the congressional acts before the Library of Commerce existed. It's
now,
all been banking.
I wanted to ask you a question. I belong to a society of Hindu people, right? I have a suspicion that there's been a lot of this human trafficking going on through this organization, which became a corporation like back in 1968.
Right, and most of the time it is. These societies and these things, a lot of them, the Oath Keepers, what was the other one that we were looking at the other day, NAACP, they've got a whole bunch of them. Those were all CIA products. Al-Qaeda is one of them. Al-Qaeda was a CIA production. This civil war in Syria, implicated by nothing other than CIA, Hezbollah is CIA. All of these groups and stuff are CIA. And what it does is it starts out as CIA, Attorney Rhodes, these kind of things. And
Attorney Rhodes.
Yeah. But as
well,
these...
We also evidenced that the CIA was involved in the plot to get rid of the spiritual teacher. It was, started the society back in 68, and through their works that actually he was poisoned with arsenic
Right, and they do it all the time, and that's the CIA. And then the CIA or FBI will maintain infiltration into these groups, and they're the extremists. So they're promoting fear on one side, they're promoting, you know, hell on the other side, and they're getting everybody all riled up and pit against each other, and then everybody rushes out to do whatever it is the CIA told them to do, and then that's when the citizen is fingered as a fall guy.
Right, well, that was the intimidation that went down. They said, well, you know, this is how it's going to go down, and if not, we'll make it, you know, worse. But, you know, they ended up poisoning this man, and he had enough arsenic in his body to kill 10 people.
Wow.
And from the autopsy report. And the disciples of this person were the ones that were convinced by the CIA to go through with the poisoning.
Right.
And it was because they were intimidated because this teacher was bringing in a different doctrine than what they wanted to be taught as religious doctrine.
Right. And they've done the reverse as well. Within Catholicism itself, when, you know, before Dr. Martin Luther King, there was Martin Luther of the Lutheran doctrine itself that had separated or appeared to separate from the Catholicism or Catholic doctrines, but that's the one in play. Lutheranism or the Lutheran doctrine is actually polycratis. That's politics itself. This is where you teach the females that the parent is the judge. The parent is the municipal corporation. The parent is the school system. The parent is the psychiatrist. And under that doctrine, here they are worshiping the thing that's preying on them and going away from the male of the family, which is their protector. And that eventually, ultimately, she turns on the male. And that's the premise of the Lutheran doctrine. But they put on this big presentation way back when Catholicism and Lutheranism, oh, they argued, and then Lutheranism was all put away. No, it wasn't. That's what is politics itself, because that was the most efficient use of the female.
Another reason why Jesus absolutely was against organized religion.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, yeah, for sure. There's a scholar named Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. He wrote a paper called Organized Religion, which I dissected it for a while. The opinions expressed in there were pretty profound and pretty much along the same lines of what Yeshua was trying to explain to these people.
Yeah, and when they got you in a, you know, organized setting, it's easier to indoctrinate the masses, you know, on what the scribes and the priests want you to take away from the scriptures instead of allowing you to read it for yourself and interpret it for yourself, because if you really knew the scriptures, you know, those priests and scribes wouldn't last long.
Not at all, especially when there's a bounty on them. I mean, that was the best thing out of all of this year. You know, Aristotle had a quote, and I'll quote Aristotle real quick. He used to say, a tyrant must put on the appearance of uncommon devotion to religion. Subjects are less apprehensive of illegal treatment from a ruler whom they consider God-fearing and pious. On the other hand, they do less easily move against him, believing that he has the gods on his side. You know, they know, and they've known forever, to teach and indoctrinate religious indoctrination in order to control the populace. If you think they're God-fearing, if they're acting in the name of God, then you're going to be more apt to believe them and less likely to move against them. You know, you don't want to displease God, right? And that's the story of Job. All throughout the story of Job, there's reference to God, and there's actions of the Lord God. There's reference to God, and there's actions of the Lord God talking with Satan. And corporate counsel and the attorneys were all gathering around Job and raising his family, killing his kids, burning his house down, killing his animals, making sure that he didn't have his income from his farm. And yet he was looking out and saying, oh, God loves me in the end, because of what? The community came around and they donated to him. They said, let me help you. And all of a sudden he looks around at the Lord God and says, God is good. You know, and it's just a sick, perpetual raising of humanity But the priests never interpret that Job in the correct manner, do they?
Because they never tell you who, you know, they twist who God is. They twist it into the Lord God, the landlord. And, again, more evidence to show that the Old Testament is nothing more than a manifest for government.
Absolutely. And when you go to Jesus, you know, his walk through Corinth. Corinth is the symbol for America. It's the same Corinthians as Americans or Spartans. And in his walk through Corinth, 1 Corinthians 6, he says, you can only fornicate by giving your body over to the Lord God. And before that point in time, he says, look, this is how you fornicate. Stop going into court. Stop patronizing the judge. Stop patronizing and sitting at the right hand of Moses, who's a judge. Matthew 23, he says, what the hell are you doing? And then he simplified it in 1 Corinthians 6. And he says to the disciples, God hath both raised up the Lord God, so shall he raise us up by his own power. Now, what does it say in the first article of the Constitution? Power's vested in Congress. So here you are, you raised up Congress to be the Lord God, and now you need to divest that power. Take it back. You're the authority. Stop asking somebody
else. I wish I could express this to so many folks that I know out here. I mean, just yesterday I was riding on the light rail, and I hear this woman going off about how much she's lost to the courts, and then she says, well, but the church says that I have to be grateful for what I do have.
Yes. The story of Job.
Right? But she's lost her house, her kids, her job, you know, all these things, and, you know, can't even afford to get on the train, and then she's talking to this other guy saying, oh, yeah, but I go to the church and they tell me just to be grateful for what I do have.
And that's, you know, it's either one or the other. We had a female recently, Bonnie, who was not contracting with the court at all. And so the church threatened to excommunicate her. And they used both tactics, which is the tactic of hearts and minds, or winning hearts and minds. And when you're threatened with excommunication or your promised benefits in exchange for just simple social behavior in a socially indoctrinated society, you're going to go either way. And if you're threatened with excommunication from the church, what do? You spring back into the church. No, no, I want to be a good girl. Let me earn that right to be. You know, and Bonnie didn't do that. She didn't contract with the court. She didn't contract with the church. And then all of a sudden, she's diagnosed with cancer because she contracted with the medical industry to receive the same social dynamics. She gets love and affection through nurses and the doctors and the staff there. As they kill her, it's in a soft sell manner. And so everybody needs to be aware of how we contract, what happens. And if they don't get you one way, they're going to get you the other way. And so everybody needs to divest themselves of all that possesses them. Just like Jesus said, stop buying the concepts. You know, a lot of us are in discomfort and disease. There's no such thing as disease. There is dis-ease and discomfort brought on by lack of human touch. Nobody's touching each other. Nobody's loving each other in this society. Everybody's watching television, and they live in a community that's surrounded by the community on the television programming. These soap operas, they establish communities, whole communities. And these females are involved in these communities, or communities that are created within these books. She's surrounded. And when she closes the book or she turns off the TV, all of a sudden she realizes she's alone, and she reaches out to the medical industry, psychological industry, court, community, politics, municipality. And all of these things are the things that prey on her, and she doesn't realize that she already is.
And all this modern literature, which is in the form of television programming these days, because, you know, they're more popular than books. You know, 100 years ago, people read books. Now they watch TV. But, you know, most of them are all selling you the same idea that you have to earn the right to be. Star Wars, the latest series on the Green Arrow called Arrow, it's all about earning the right to be. You know, and then they sell the attorneys and the cops as the good guys, of course.
Right. That kind of roots back to the sacrament of penance, right? We have to earn our right to be.
Yeah.
Yep, and that's what they taught you in the first...
You can earn forgiveness by, like, the lady who pushed her the newlywed husband over the cliff and killed him. She gets to do 30 years, and she's forgiven.
You know, it's just sick. And feminism teaches the female that she doesn't exist until she earns the right to be through working, being out of the home, bending over backwards, garnering title. Feminism is preying on females. And the voice of feminism is nothing but psychopathic females. You have Dianne Feinstein up there on the Senate Intelligence Committee working as the CIA. She's the director of the CIA. And she stands up there on C-SPAN on the House floor and says, all of these females are being abused. Let's offer them some more hearts and minds. Now, that's Henry Kissinger's
right.
program.
And as soon as a male comes up to assert his authority, then, you know, she feels like, well, I can go tell daddy on him.
Right, right. And it's not even him asserting his authority. Now, you know, I used to be indoctrinated. If I was told, no, we can't afford that, or whatever else, I would be hurt emotionally. Those don't exist. Emotions are socially created.
Oh, sure. Absolutely.
Okay, and so she's taught, and I never played into this game because I just couldn't, but she's taught that, you know, if you're hurting financially, you won't be if you come over here. They can offer you welfare benefits. They can offer you housing. They can offer you free schooling to make it better so you can work more and produce more. That's the action of hearts and minds. So if she's not comfortable living as to her means, there's always that other opportunity to run to. That's the snake in the garden. But feminism and the related programming, that is the snake in the garden. That's somebody in your garden promising you all sorts of shit off of the tree of knowledge. And what you're doing is you're buying those concepts. And in that, that is the definition in Black's Law Dictionary of civil death. You've abjured the realm. If you go off to another father, you've given up the garden. Now it has it. Because now you're adhering to its laws, subscribing or underwriting policy, and under its jurisdiction, you're calling it the owner of your garden.
Yeah, I suppose I see your point. Sure.
Yeah. And all it takes is indoctrinating you with the title. Man is a legal fiction. You're a state of being. You're not man or woman. Those are signifying that gender. The word stems from genus. It's signifying or evidencing that you're a different species other than a human being. A state of being.
How would the legal language defines sentient, the word sentient.
That's a legal creation. Sentience is created by the attorneys. They're the ones that have been telling you that you're alive, or that you were conceived, or when you begin living. God didn't create those words. Biology is biology. The word biology stems from life itself. B-I means life. B.I. means two parts. Two parts. It just means two parts that are animate. Two parts of anything animate is life. Dirt is life. It's all biology. Rock is life. Trees are life. Human is life. An attorney has come in and redefined life and told you that you could kill it in a legal manner called abortion. That is sick. That is sick. It's absolutely horrifying.
Yeah, I watch it in my community every day.
It's worse in certain cultures. In the Netherlands, elderly people actually feel now that they're useless bread gobblers, and there's a higher suicide rate. There's higher rate of euthanasia. Here in this country, in the United States, quote, incorporated, not in this country because it never existed as a country or a geographical state. We're being taught that children are useless bread gobblers. They're criminalizing our children for skateboarding, for Christ's sakes, in Canada. They're criminalizing our children for vandalizing buildings, for injuring buildings. Not for harm upon humanity.
Yeah, we had that cop there in Orange County. I wonder whatever happened to that kid. The guy had him pinned down, allegedly for some sort of vandalism, spray painting or whatever. And, you know, this is a little 10-year-old kid, and he speaks Spanish, and somebody's trying to talk to the kid in Spanish, you know, to de-escalate the situation, and the cop's like, don't speak Spanish.
It's just sick. They treat children like they're garbage, and this is written in the first and second welfare theorem. The corporate welfare thought process. And this is written in a book by Thomas Roeder.
Doesn't that kind of defeat the purpose? I mean, if they're going to securitize on these beings, shouldn't they take good care of them?
No, they don't need them because they breed. They're treating human beings as if it's a farm. It's called human husbandry.
Uh-huh.
And that's what they're doing. They're just farming human beings.
And they do it through all these mechanisms. There's this thing set up a long time ago called total spectrum dominance. And that's why you have all... You know, you have all these sides. You got your right, your left, you got your alternative, you got your patriots. And they're all selling you down to the same road that leads to Rome.
I was brought up to think that slavery was quite okay because my parents brought me a 5-year-old sister when I was 5 years old as a playmate. And my dad said, he worked for the USDA, and he came home one day and he says, we bought you a sister.
Oh.
And they took her off the Indian reservation.
Wow.
Because the CPS said, well, there was cockroaches in the house, and they had to put the cereal in the refrigerator to keep the cockroaches away, so that was reason to take her out of the home.
Right.
And yeah, and that code that allowed that was created by attorneys.
Right, and when you go all the way back, you can find this in the 1924... Racial Integrity Act of Virginia that was interpreted by the rest of the states. And the off-color children are treated worse than white children. This is what they do. You can go to the Stolen Generation when they did it in Australia through CPS. You can go to any country. Syria will have it soon. Israel, Palestine. Everywhere has been raised by attorneys, and they get rid of the off-color children because people are not believing or realizing the self. We're black and white because of vitamin D exposure only. But if we're pit up against each other, and if we're separate, and we're taking all of these titles and calling ourselves all these fictions, black, white, red, yellow, female, male, the attorney can cash in. It can only cash in, and genocide can only occur if there's classification, if there's dehumanization. Right. And that's what Satan teaches in his Hitler youth camps.
Right. Well, I got a good dose of learning when I went to Hotel California over there in Tulare County for 111 days. And I could see everything that was going on in there, how they separate the people and by the races and
pit them against each other.
Different gangs, and they pit people against each other.
Right.
And, you know, I even saw a few people got murdered.
Right. And it's horrifying. It's absolutely horrifying. No human being should have to experience these things.
Yeah, the more we're parted out, the better off it is for the attorneys' practices and to do what they do. We can't ever stand together because we're all dividing and squabbling amongst ourselves over things that really don't even matter in the first place.
Right. Well, I asked them, that, you know, when they took me in there, I said, you know, I'm kind of like, you know, I need to be kept by myself. I don't know what I might do to somebody. They kept it, you know, they kept it, so they put me in a place, but I recognized in there was like, there was three different gangs that were going on, and you know, as I tried to inquire, well, why are the gangs against each other? They couldn't figure out a reason even why. Right? They have no clue even why they don't like each other.
And just to be clear, this is what you, because you were locked up in the pokey?
Yeah. They put me in the lower chambers of the Exchequer for 111 days because I thought I was going to control the judge's courtroom, and he slapped me with a psych eval.
Oh, really? So this is stemming up from that same court case that you came into in the first place thinking you were going to get some help.
Yeah, well, I sent them some paperwork back in 2009 that they didn't recognize, and then they proceeded to publish a warrant saying I didn't show up and this and that and the other thing. And then, it all came down like that. But, you know, I just look at it as part of my learning process for sure.
Right. Yeah. Send us those documents. You can add me to Skype at T. Pepperman. And as soon as I get those documents, and I'll look through them, and make sure that you do your F&E docs. What that does, and I want to be absolutely clear here. As a clerk of the United States Court, the reason that your docs are required is not only because a court can only protect you if you're in that jurisdiction. If you're subscribing to another jurisdiction, you know, I can't do anything for you unless you petition the court. However, because our court acts under public law, I don't get paid for anything. The court does not cash in on renting your body to another. The court does not cash in. That is always, always, always human trafficking. It is always, 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 always a criminal enterprise. So what you need to do is you need to put down your F&E docs, which and your fee schedule, which says this is where that goes. This is where those monies go. This is what they're for. If you're coming in as the United States, of course, that goes for the general welfare of all of humanity and shuts them down easier as the foreclosure occurs. But we don't get paid. We're not into human trafficking. We're not into prostitution. I'm not a pimp. Our judges are not pimps. Our judges are only judges. The only function of an actual judge bound by judicial canon is to view evidence and rule accordingly. They're not supposed to be slipped money under the table by a corporation to rule in their favor. They're not supposed to be bonding anything. That's the function of a bishop. They're not supposed to be issuing arrest warrants. They're not supposed to be doing any of these things unless there's evidence, absolute evidence of criminal activity, which of course is in everybody's court record because that's what the United States Incorporated does. Their courts founded on the 1789 Judiciary Act, and you can read that in 28 USC United States Code, is a banking schematic. It created 13 banks.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. I've read all the documents on your site, that study documents you put there. I haven't absorbed everything, but I did think it through, and was able to understand what you're saying there.
Good, and then just get your docs done so that your house is standing, and then send us your evidence. And you know, evidence is evidence. Evidence is evidence is evidence. So you can send it to me in email. You can send it to me in Skype. You don't have to pay a process server. You don't have to pay an attorney to carry it from one place to another. You don't have to register, mail it. All of that stuff is attorney work product doctrine, and these are products of the corporation.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can't, I don't know how much we've spent on certified mailings, on, you know, overnight mail because we've had to and everything else, but the attorneys at the back end are always cashing in on these things. So we try at the United States Court to cut out all of that. We're not a middleman. We are only your voice. We're your court, and we function as the court was originally intended.
Right. That would be my goal as well, of course.
Right, and our law enforcement is already on the ground. They started foreclosure this last couple weeks here, and you'll see it coming even quicker than it has been, and we're seeing it very, very swiftly as it is. But as this goes along, it'll be even more apparent, I'm pretty sure, because it's like, you know, once we got over the top of the hill and we're coming down, we're slowly building momentum, but man, oh man, the physics of what's going on is, you know, it'll pick up speed and just here in a moment.
Yeah.
Was there a break in between your stay at the hotel, whatever, here?
Can you say that again? I didn't catch
it. Did you serve the full 110 days consecutively?
Yes.
So they already violated the rules of war as the United Nations.
Yeah, I informed them of that.
Right, but you didn't have any force behind you at that time.
Yeah, I informed them of everything that they were doing, and like you said, just let them do what they're going to do so that we can have evidence.
Good. Yeah, just send me the evidence now, and we'll start on that, but I do need you to do the F&E docs, because otherwise I can't go forward. We don't take any kind of payment, and so we need your house established. And
right, and initially when they picked me up on this warrant, I definitely did not give them the surname that they have let us patent claim on. I didn't give that to them, but they put my fingers on their little device and decided that I was connected to that.
Right. And when they did that, did they have your fee schedule?
Well, because the place that I was taken from, I didn't have a copy of that. I do have a copy in my briefcase, and so I put them on notice that it existed, and that I charge $1 million a day for the detainment.
Right. What did you point out a location of your fee schedule or no?
Verbally, I explained to them that it existed and that I could get that for them, but of course, that wasn't able to happen.
All right.
And my partner, she's not competent to deal with them.
Right.
Anyway, so yeah.
Well, none of us
really
should.
Has no force behind me, and trying to take care of it at the arraignment. The judge wasn't having it under any circumstances.
Right.
So. Yeah, none of us should have to know any of this stuff,
No.
But, I mean, we had to, of course.
I'm halfway competent in the courtroom. You understand? I am.
Yeah, it sounds like you would be. However, their courts is not the place you want to be as a sovereign state, because if you're in there at all, for whatever reason, they got you, buddy. You know? You're under their jurisdiction.
Well, I said the public defender that they assigned to me, he asked me, has your state ever been held under conservatorship? And then I asked him a question. I was like, well, what do you mean by conservatorship? Because I know that his legal language, what it is, but he wouldn't answer the question. He just ran out of the room and said, well, let me see if the judge will recontract with you. And he just rolled over on me.
Right, and this
at that point, before I could even have a conversation about, how we should proceed, he just ran
right
out of there.
And this is back in 2009, right?
There's recently this 2013. I had not had any negative interaction with any law enforcement after I was initially released, and then I sent them paperwork that was not recognized. I thought that the warrant would be, not a thing. And then I find out in 2013, back in August, that it was.
Right, but not our paperwork. You're talking about a different process?
What's that? No, I sent them an executor letter.
Right, is it my executor letter or somebody else's?
No, it was, you know, actually, at that time, I put everything in there, and it was a combination between what I had read from, studied from what David Clarence's process.
And then I
also put some other things in there, in the general executor document that Frank O'Collins had.
Right. So, but that's not our process, and so.
Right, and I recognize why it didn't work, and and so I'm still stuck at dealing with this, and at this point, anything that I do, I don't expect it to be recognized in this, in any of these courts.
Right, and and again, after we get off the phone and everything, send me all of these things, and we'll go through them and see what all we can do. But
they would not even give me a single piece of paper while I was in there. They never presented me with anything that I requested. I never got a single piece of paper presented to me until I had to sign to get my property back.
Right.
And I, even that I signed under duress.
Right.
So, I asked. Been evidencing myself in sovereign capacity for some years, but I just really haven't had any ability to enforce that.
Right, so. And just send us through everything, and then we'll go through it and see what's going on here, and then we'll see what we can do. But we need the F&E docs done. First and foremost, the forgiveness in the executor doc, which obliterates the franchise and then takes executorship over it within both the hostile takeover of the franchise and then the backflip takeover of the franchise, which is what an executor is doing. You're facilitating hostile takeovers of what they claimed as their property. And you're allowing them, by placing that as a deed, to come in and argue you and say, no, we have a claim on this. They don't have a claim on the property, but you have to let it play out. And then on top of that, you need the fee schedule, which goes along with my process, which says, they've been tricking you out upwards of $33 billion on your estate and pooling these assets with a bunch of others. And so they're cashing in every time you turn around from cradle to grave. And that's the premise of our fee schedule, is that $33 billion. If it doesn't hurt them, they're not going to stop. If you don't take their estates trading for yours, they're not going to stop. And what they're facilitating when they're facilitating commerce and navigation is, of course, shipping under 46 USC. 46 USC 31325 says, okay, you want to maintain a lien on a public vessel? When the owner shows up to claim the vessel, you're volunteering to assume all of the charges against the vessel. You're volunteering to assume this lien. And that's why there's a $33 billion fee on our fee schedule, because that's what they're volunteering to assume.
Okay.
So what we're doing is...
The objective for my fee schedule was to deterrent as well. I was not really... trying to collect a million a day. It's not really, it's not important to me, but you're saying that it needs to be a higher amount.
Right, because what you're doing is, Jesus taught us that when the Lamb is able to open the book and you realize what they're doing upon you, the Lamb, you're required by God's law to kill them as they killed the Lamb. And so if they have a $33 billion lien against your estate and your loved ones, then that needs to be on them. You're not the felon. You're not the one that declared bankruptcy in 1933.
Right.
You've never harmed a human being.
I feel kind of like I'm blocked in many different ways because I'm dealing with such a high level of corruption, and it's in every county, all over the place.
It's very sophisticated. They've been developing this technique going back to Rome, at least, if not Egypt.
That's what Moses was. Moses was one of their attorneys in black dresses. He wasn't a help to humankind. He came in to cash in on your demise. Well, who was facilitating your demise? in the story of Job, it says exactly who that is. It's corporate counsel and the attorney, Satan. It's the Lord God and Satan. And what they're doing is they're pitting you against your family members. They're burning down your house for the insurance claim. They're killing all of your animals through the EPA and saying, oh, they have bird flu. Oh, your pigs have this. Oh, your cows have this. And they do it every day right in front of everybody's eyes, but nobody's realizing that's your walk.
Right. So would it be appropriate to send this public defender, Cheryl Smith, any paperwork? Because I had a conversation with her, and she said she was happy to accept any of the associated liabilities, but the only thing that she didn't want to do was jail time. Right?
Hmm. Right. We don't go after
that. I thought to hold her to that because she accepted the offer to accept the liabilities personally.
Well, she's already doing that with her indemnity bond. She's holding harmless corporate counsel. But the sheriff is not the director. Corporate counsel is the one that's the conservator over the bankruptcy. Corporate counsel is the one that has to diagnose you by sticking you in jail and calling you a criminal. Otherwise, they can't discharge congressional bankruptcy. It's not the sheriff.
Right, well,
the sheriff is just enforcing policy. They don't realize that they're human trafficking the majority of the time. And what Congress has
the courts are of the opinion that I'm I need to be maintained on antipsychotic medication.
Right, because that kills you slowly.
Because I don't know how to contract with them under their courts.
Right, those are the same drugs used in lethal injections. And if you go read a book by Thomas Roeder, it's called Psychiatrist, The Men Behind Hitler.
Yeah.
What corporate counsel is doing is killing you slowly, but it looks like you're going to die of natural causes. Eventually.
I told them they could give me, they could give me some lithium to kind of show me the fuck out while I was in there. Because I take a natural form of lithium anyway, when I get a little anxious. Right, and that's what the psychologists had suggested that I do in order to please the judge, because he said the judge really likes that.
The psychiatrist that
came in to do the exam. Now he showed me. He asked me some questions. He asked me how I like the president, and then he showed me a picture of him shaking hands with Barack Obama. He was a black psychologist called Dr. James.
Right, psychiatrist.
He was letting me know that I need to have a good attitude about
psychiatrist.
What's going on here?
Psychiatrist. Psychologists study the thought of the psyche or the mind. Psychiatrist likes it. Psychiatrist is there to destroy the mind. And so we have to make sure that we're always speaking as to the actor, because we don't want to hurt a whole bunch of psychologists. You know, I was trained in psychology and I had no idea about any of this until I became proficient in political science. And then it all came together and I don't really want to be painted as something evil or harmful for society at all. The psychiatrists are actually practicing the art of psychology, which means they're nothing more than an attorney. However, a psychiatrist lyses the mind. It splits the mind. And it teaches you all these concepts. And priests are a lesser form of psychiatrists, but they're the same thing.
Well, you know, the detailed conversation that I had with this psychiatrist, which actually, you know, finally explained that I was, that he felt that I was able to cooperate with counsel. But I had an in-depth conversation with him, and he didn't say that I was wrong. He said that he didn't disagree about my position, but he said that it was in my best interest just to go along with what they want.
Right, and you know him as now a ringer, right, for the court process?
Well, I mean, I recognize his position really from the beginning, but, you know, I mean, I think these conversations that we're having, they probably recorded them, but, you know, I'm having a feeling that this is something that maybe, you know, evidencing what they're doing, maybe we could, you know, bring it to a stop.
Absolutely. That's our function.
It all starts. It all starts with psychiatry and a diagnosis. That's all the whole thing got kicked off in the beginning.
I kind of feel reluctant even to go into a courtroom now because they did that to me.
Right. You don't want to go into their court. That's what Jesus said in 1 Corinthians 6. Never appear before them because you're there as a special.
It ends up being by force, and you know, even though I'm not claiming anything that isn't my property.
Well, no, because you've been indoctrinated to follow those other processes. So when you study our process and you realize what it is, Infinity Docs, you're taking over the franchise and you're asking them to go ahead. They have a year and a day to make a claim on that estate and prove that it's theirs. Okay?
Uh-huh. That's what
you're right. Okay, so at that inception, they have 1 year and 1 day to come in and contract with you. So they're going to use all manner of force under fourth generation warfare. They're going to hit you in the pocket through your bank account, see if you want to come back and contract with them. They're going to shut off your electricity to see if you want to contract with them and garner benefits. They're going to try to attempt on your children. You have to hold them accountable at each turn, which is what the case is that we have up on ChooseYourSide.org.
Uh-huh.
And what this is a test. Do you know thyself? Jesus said what? Uh-huh. Know thyself. Who's the authority? Now, you have a Lord God that came into your garden and offered you all sorts of concepts through the action of psychiatry, psychological warfare, and it ended up giving you all sorts of names and titles. And Jesus directs how to get away from that. Divest yourself of all that possesses you. Now, if you appear in their jurisdiction and you enter into their jurisdiction and then cry out, you don't have jurisdiction over me, that's the action of an infant. And under the laws of infant, that judge, the executor over the estate, is going to protect you. But if you stand outside of their court and you say, here's my forgiveness, my F&E docs, forgiveness and executor docs, look, the franchise is gone. Here's my ordinance of the estate. It says you're a privateer. Your cops are bringing me into courts of admiralty for condemnation and sale. I already know this. And here's my fee schedule if you would like to do that. If you would like to further contract with the executor of this state, go ahead and pick me up.
Okay. That's pretty clear.
Yeah, I haven't been into a courtroom once since, in this position, but I haven't been to any of their courts.
I've never willingly walked in there and from the outside. They've always had to kidnap me and force me to go in there.
Right, and when you're, if you're commingling and you're doing that Franco Collins stuff and you're doing all of those other things,
I'm not actually doing those. I don't really care to do somebody else's process, right? So what I was attempting to do in that instance was just my own process and let them know that I'm competent to be the executor.
Right, but then if you...
the general executor of the state, so that they can't be mistaken that any other executor.
Right, but at every turn, such as these attorneys, Satan is good at summoning the dead, for example. So you get a summon in the mail and you do something with it, and the first something you do is you accept it through the mail being posted under the 1794... Treaty of Amity, Commerce, and Navigation. And so if you're accepting and using, assuming that fiction, what you're doing is you're allowing them to post your bond for you because you're using that fiction. And on a daily basis, you're accepting mail, right? In the name of the fiction, you get all these coupons and you get newspapers and you get all these things in the name of the fiction. Under 18 U.S.C. 1342, they have you as a felon for using that last name. Because you're not using the proper name. And so as that felon...
Even though I've made a copyright claim on it?
Right, it doesn't matter because, and that's what Jesus said the most, Matthew 23, all over, he says, you know what, you're known by your works and actions. So if you say, that's not me, and then you accept male in that name, assuming and using that fiction, you're evidencing by your works and actions that you're acting as that fiction. And so you have to stop them, and that's what our effing
does. Yeah, that's good, because I haven't for at least a decade accepted, anything other than private mail, not anything from
that. Right, but it doesn't matter, because each mailing is canceled, that's a canceled check.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So as you're receiving, you're accepting and using.
So then anything that is going to come, then is. I mean, I had this idea of just making a stamp from Office Depot, and returned it to sender.
Right, that's what we do, because if you do not and you open something like that, you are using and assuming a fictional name or address, which is listing you as a felon under 18 U.S.C. subsection 1342. And I'll read it real quick.
And if you've divested yourself...
I have it copied down several times on my little notepad on my smartphone here, so...
If we...
Go ahead and read that.
If you've divested yourself by doing the... appointment of the executor and in our process here, then if you open one piece of mail, you just recontract and you got to do them again in reality for the to be absolutely correct. So yeah, you bet. I had a stamp made up and I used it religiously till the mail just stopped.
I haven't been receiving any, but once I get into this mailing again, I'm sure I'm going to use that.
Well, let me read that real quick. 18 U.S.C. subsection 1342, fictitious name or address. Whoever, for the purpose of conducting, promoting, or carrying on by means of the Postal Service, any scheme or device mentioned in Section 1341 of this title or any other unlawful business, uses or assumes title, name, or address or other name other than its own proper name, or takes, receives from any post office or authorized depository of mail matter any letter, postal card, package, or any other mail matter addressed to any such fictitious, false, or assumed title, name, or address, or name other than its own proper name, shall be fined under this title or imprisoned not more than 5 years or both. Now, when you find yourself attacked constantly, it's stemming from the 1794 Treaty of Amity, Commerce, and Navigation. Congress posted you, the United States of Being, to discharge its congressional bankruptcy, taught you to use that fictional name or address. The proper name is only the first middle. The family name means you're a different genus, like Eric's son, or Smith, which means blacksmith, silversmith. We know friends with the last name Champagne. That means you're from an area in France, Champagne, France. These things are not you. That's not your relative being. Those are fictions. And so when you're taking up those titles, those fictional names or addresses, and using and assuming them, you're being charged as a felon and held, as, of course, as a prisoner of war. And, of course, the only way, and this is the most important, the only way for you to be civilly dead is for you to be a felon or having abjured your realm, given up that garden. And the second you take up somebody else telling you that you're a described piece of property, you've abjured the realm. You've partaken from the tree of knowledge, which only bears these concepts, fictional names and addresses. You've eaten it up, bought into the idea, which is what the law merchant sells you. The law merchant sells you all these concepts. And at that time, what does it say? It's written, you die. If you eat from the tree of knowledge, you're going to experience life and death. So under civil death, this is how you're being maintained. This is how you're being administrated. And it's all written. start with the crucifixion itself, the Coronation Charter or Charter of Liberties. Do you have anything else to say, Bo? Because we're going on like 3.5 hours.
Okay, yeah, there's a couple of headlines I wanted to hit yet, since we're just trying to cover some Monday news as it ties in here. See if I can find it again. My browser's crashed at least twice here on this stupid Windows computer. Where'd it go now? lost the thing. But there was that one, and the guy that is a Nazi false flag that shot them
Jewish
people. Yeah, you know, he's saying Heil Hitler and all that.
CIA production to pit humanity once again. You know, it's we've been teaching.
They're waving the dog again from World War II.
Right, and they have to, because people are realizing, the sheeple are now realizing that they live in Nazi Germany, that this is a corporate structure, that this is a corporation. It's always been maintained the same way. So now they have this new Hitler out there screaming Heil Hitler and massacring Jews, which of course is always the CIA. This is Dianne Feinstein, the chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee. You can find, you know, all sorts of stuff about Hatch, Orrin Hatch, Harry Reid himself.
Anti-Semitism, again, yep. They're selling.
Yep. And we're not racist. Human beings are not
and
racist.
And they killed three human beings to do it.
Right. Look at what they did to
Floyd. You know, I mean, well, and this is, you know, this is amazing. If you look at, it was just over a week ago on American Dad, okay? I sent you that episode. Did you watch it? About the...
oh, my goodness.
Honey, I'm Homeland was the title of the episode. And, in the, you know, they perpetuate this great big plot, you know, to...
infiltrate.
Yeah. Get Agent Smith to infiltrate a protester group who was itself its own organization.
Through the CIA.
Also the CIA, and Smith didn't know it. You know, they brainwash him into being one of him and get him to basically attack Mount Rushmore. So, and in the end, they find out that it was a great big elaborate plot to test the Mount Rushmore missile defense system. And when Smith says to the director, says, well, why couldn't we just... why do we have to go through all this? And he said, well, we had a bunch of Homeland...
security monies laying around.
Yeah, Homeland Security's money. We had funds that we had to use up. And it's exactly how they operate.
Yes. And they're providing everybody now in these cartoons that we're normally used to indoctrinate.
Of course, somebody died along the way, too, you know. And
right.
They just said sorry at the end, you know.
Right, and it's the same identical thing, but that now they're disclosing to you, the sheeple, the listeners, what actually occurs through the cartoon, which has been their medium of indoctrination for a long time. Cartoons, comedy, the formula for comedy is tragedy plus time. So as that occurs, comedy occurs, this is called human conditioning. So they're conditioning you to enjoy that type of behavior, to enjoy that type of thing. We started out with, you know, go all the way back to Abbott and Costello and then the Three Stooges. And along the lines, human beings were taught that it's funny for people to have, you know, be beaten in the head with a 2x4 and poking people's eyes out and everything else. And this has just conditioned humanity not only to dehumanize the fellow being, but also to laugh at those instances. And then it's gotten to the extent now they have such as, quote, America's Funniest Videos, and that's just sick.
Yeah, so this guy, he's the founder and the former leader of the Carolina Knights of the Ku Klux Klan and the White Patriot Party, according to the Southern Poverty Law Center. Man, let's see here. This guy's 73 years old. I don't know. It's got all the earmarks of him being a tool.
Absolutely. Have you been to the site for the Southern Poverty Law Center? hold some time here while I go get that up, because I wanted to share that with the listeners so that they know what's going on. When you go to the Southern Poverty Law Center itself, the board of directors, and then, of course, the leadership in the Southern Poverty Law Center is the CIA itself. They've got, who is it? Heidi Barish as the intelligence project director. And so this Heidi Barish is the one that's writing the script for these things.
So anyways, yeah, his name is Fraser Glenn Miller.
Absolutely.
Glenn Miller.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, and of course,
when you go back to the inception of the KKK, that was the Democratic Party. It was Congress.
Yep. I'm smelling a production on that one. Let's see here. We got the Russian plane buzzed a U.S. ship. I guess that's on the top of the headlines now, and it's more beating the war drums, and of course, it's basically all under Congress since 1941, so again, what's going on there?
Same game that Reagan was playing with the Cold War. Gorbachev, bring down this wall. I'm not going to touch your gun rights or anything. And then all of a sudden, the Secret Service pings Reagan in an assassination attempt, paralyzes Brady, and then who's blamed? A citizen is blamed. He's kept in a mental institution. This is relative to the last caller we just had.
Tell you, you know, about the, you know, the do as I say, not as I do type mentality of Congress. Tax writing lawmakers with their own tax issues, of course, you know, they're always like getting away with being tax cheats and all that.
Now they're saying they're victims. This is identical to just a couple weeks ago, Dianne Feinstein came in and said that the NSA was spying on her, but she's the chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee. She's the one that directs the NSA through the CIA, created through the 1947 National Security Act.
Google buys drone maker. So now, not only did they buy the eight largest robotic companies on the planet, but now they're getting into drone making. Okay. So we got that to look forward to and or take care of at some point. Google has just basically destroyed YouTube. YouTube is just the messaging is just crap, and they just shut down the information flow. Keeping up with your subscribers is, or who you're subscribed to is, just, you know, more and more taxing every time they come up with an upgrade. Let's see, hungry spouses are more aggressive. Hangry? H-A-N-G-R-Y? I'm not even sure what that means.
It might be a typo.
Maybe a CNN typo. Yeah, their funding is lacking.
Diminishing.
They can't even afford to spell check anymore. And so we got the animation. They got showing the Russian flyover. Okay, they're gonna wag the dog on that one there over and over again too. Probably. See, look at these Russians.
They have a flag.
let's see. We got the ramping up the Ebola scare. Whatever's happening there.
Well, and usually these plagues, and all of the listeners need to realize what these plagues are. Bacterium survives on sugar, carbohydrates. So as a populace is imposed upon through the inflation rate being higher and higher, and all of these things are so expensive, they're forced to rely on food banks, WIC programs. They eat a lot of cereals and high carbohydrates. And so if there's a bacterial influence in the community, such as anthrax, which is what they always do, and this is in their anthrax hearing documents from 98. They had admitted dosing everybody in the United States Incorporated back before the 70s. And that's why when they came out with the swine flu, quote, swine flu, which is H1N1, it's the production that the body produces, hydrogen one part, nitrogen one part, when it's dosed with variants on anthrax. So everybody needs to realize when these plagues occur, these massive illnesses, this is through fourth generation warfare. You need to back out off of the sugars, try to come back into an alkaline state using sample products. Baking soda is an alkaline. Make sure you read these boxes to make sure that there's no aluminum in it, because that could be more detrimental than anything. But do get your body back into an alkaline state. Stay away from the carbohydrates, and it'll skip over you. Bacteria requires high sugar states.
And of course, the medical industry is not going to tell you that colloidal silver kills all pathogens.
Absolutely.
Even Ebola. Let's see. So learn how to make and or, you know, have some colloidal silver on hand for whatever ails you. Over at the United Nations and international human rights groups joined a growing call urging the Iranian government to call off the impending execution of a 26-year-old woman convicted of murder. Now, apparently, Rehana Jabari was sentenced to death for the 2007 killing of Morteza Abdullaya Sarbande, a former employee of Iran's Ministry of Intelligence and Security.
Was it in self-defense? She killed an agent. Was
yeah,
it in self-defense?
I know. And,
you know, it depends on if she actually harmed a human being or if she
killed a psychopath. That's the question. That's the question I don't have all the answers on yet. But, I mean, if there was evidence under the public law that she had harmed somebody, which she's still sitting around for in jail, if it was in self-defense or because of her trying to stop this individual from killing a bunch of people, then she's totally within her rights.
Absolutely, and she's
standing
innocent.
Up for humanity.
Right.
So that's the thing under the public law. It's not this, you know, draw it out and, you know, 5, 10, 20-year court process to see if we're going to put you on death row. Is there any evidence you harmed somebody? If there's evidence you killed somebody,
you're done.
For, you know, any other reason other than self-defense or, you know, the protection of humanity, then you're guilty of murder.
Right.
Unless it's... And you got to be removed from harming society.
Right. Simple. There's no attorney work product under public law. There's no statute of limitation. There's no games. There's no psych evals to find out why you killed somebody. There's no psych eval to limit your culpability if you've intentionally harmed a human being. There's none of that stuff. It's just really swift. Nobody cashes in on anybody else's demise other than if you take somebody's life with intent to harm a human being, they get your estate. Period. You're done.
So, let's see, back to the theatrics with Russia. West eyes more Russia sanctions, according to the headline on the BBC. And again, you know, Putin's just clergy for Congress, and again, it's a big play going on here.
Absolutely.
So,
the Russian Federation.
Hearts and minds.
Yep, Russian Federation, it's part of the Perpetual Union, the Confederacy.
Let's see, I was going to try to get over to the Daily Mail, see what was going on in the Daily Mail, but let's see, I don't have that pulled up. Let's see. Thousands of New York gun owners could become felons overnight come Tuesday. That's tomorrow. Owners of assault weapons in New York will be faced with a choice. Register those firearms with the state or potentially face a felony charge. Well, they've already deemed you as a felon. Just for assuming that fictitious last franchise name, you know, guns not the felon make, as Yoda might say. But of course, the Jedi don't adhere to public law either, so I don't know why I'm using Yoda. Anyways, let's see. Let's see, over the Daily Mail, let's see, the headline is, exclusive, they're not mine, estranged husband of woman who admitted to killing six of her newborn baby, says he isn't the father and that she was kicked out of the house for cheating.
She's absolutely depraved. This is sick.
But she's the one that always gets custody of the kids, too.
Right.
Two sex offenders out on patrol, or parole, went on a savage rape and murder spree that left five women dead, all while wearing their GPS ankle bracelets. Oh, isn't that nice?
They were under the watchful gaze of the court system as they were killing people. That's sick.
Well, creating more business for the courts, aren't they? That's what it's all about. Let's see, what else? We had that Twitter from U.S. Airwaves that tweeted a triple X-rated picture to customers complaining their flight was late.
Oh, that's disgusting. I wouldn't want to see that. That's just sad. People throwing fits like children.
Well, it sounds like somebody was... who was doing the tweeting may have another browser window open with something else and then accidentally sent the link to that instead of what he was supposed to.
Yeah.
So, let's see. Watching porn on the job, that's just the American way, I guess. Hero, 18-year-old smashed window and pulled California bus crash victims from the flaming wreckage before he died in tragedy that killed 10.
Aww.
So that's going back to that story we talked about the first hour with the 10 people that died there out in California with the FedEx bus running into the school bus. Okay. Which, again, people, wouldn't happen if you weren't sending your kids off to school in these corporate school buses on those corporate roads of commerce that are everybody's trying to get there to punch in on time. See, Dutch teen, 14, is arrested in Rotterdam after tweeting joke Al-Qaeda bomb threat to American Airlines. Oh, my goodness.
Little babies, and those are commercial crimes. He didn't harm anybody. And I know that that's not appropriate, but it doesn't violate the public law.
Boy's head found in home of Pakistani cannibals who had dug up more than 100 corpses from the local graveyard and eaten them.
Yeah, that one's a CIA presentation. That's what they were saying way back when, that Muslim men were burning their widows after death to prevent inheritance. That would be the attorney rather than the dead guy. You know, he's buried.
From Ford Mustang to colonies on the moon, predictions that the 1964 World's Fair got right and what they got very wrong.
Oh, yeah, they were introducing commerce to the sheeple citizens.
Yeah, that's when we were just starting allegedly to go to the moon. And let's see. He's lucky to still have a girlfriend. Boy asks his date to the prom in the form of a very convincing college rejection letter.
Why would you do that? Like, you know, everything's walked away from nature. Absolutely walked away from nature. When you're writing to somebody and when you're not meeting them as to their energy and scent, that's how every other biology except for humans mate. They don't mate based on looking like Barbie. They don't mate based on having a Ford Mustang in the driveway. They don't mate based on having that Hummer in the driver in the garage or a mansion on the hill. That is not how other biology mates. And human beings have been so perverted and so twisted and so split and pit up against each other. It's just so sad.
The transcript of Ron Paul's farewell address to Congress... I think that's from November of 2012. And good riddance. You're getting another Congress member. Get them out of there. Get them all out of there. I don't care if your name's Ron Paul or Rand Paul. You're all human trafficking us. What kind of garbage you selling us here, Ron Paul? Outrage after Texas police Officer broke student's arm with an audible snap after he was already restrained as he and fellow officer stopped a school fight.
What was the purpose of stopping a school fight if you were going to break one of the fighter's arms? Tell me what the purpose of corporate security is. There is something very, 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 very wrong here. If law enforcement is saying that to stop a fight, they have to harm somebody, which is the reason supposedly they're going to stop the fight in the first place. No. Corporate counsel needs everybody to be injured and brought into law.
Well, I guess they should feel luckily, you know, lucky that they weren't shot to death.
Sick. That was like that suicide victim out in Spokane. He was threatening to commit suicide. No, he didn't commit suicide. He was threatening to commit suicide. And we've seen that over and over again. People need attention. They feel alone and everything else. And so they're threatening. Well, the law enforcement officers, Spokane police, tased him and made sure that he died falling off of that bridge. What was the point of them being there if they were going to tase him off and kill him anyway?
Yeah, just more attorney work product doctrine, better business.
Sick.
Gas prices soar, $4.59 a gallon spreading across the U.S. There's another way they're raising you. After they drill those refinery, after they drill for the oil, and oil's coming up there, it doesn't cost them anything. And that's besides the fact that corporations were supposed to be here for our benefit in the first place.
Right. Now I want to bring that up. Now, we have, remember the Beverly Hillbillies? And he was shooting at the ground, and he came up with some oil.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so he found that oil. Now, BP said the same thing when they punched into under the seabed there, and they punched in, and they said, we're losing 100,000 gallons of oil per day. And so they took that loss. They never lost it because they only found it. They took that loss and they shared it with you, the human being. You got to pay for those losses. You got to pay for all of those things. And it was just sick. It's foul that humanity would even accept these types of things.
Let's see. Pictured in their mugshots, the disgraced South Carolina politician, 51, and his 22-year-old girlfriend, whose pregnancy scare appears in Southern Charm. Former Southern Carolina Treasurer Thomas Ravenel was put away for 10 months in 2008 on federal cocaine charges. The millionaire former real estate developer now appears on Bravo's Southern Charm series.
Aw, he got rewarded and benefited for all of his politics. This is how these actors change their faces. He was an actor when he was the treasurer. He's an actor now, but you see it as two different things. The sheeple see this as two different things. They're always actors. They tell you, they make acts, congressional acts.
Al Franken is one that people recognize, though, as an actor.
Absolutely, and he sits right
comedian there
on the Senate Judiciary Committee.
Oh, he thinks it's real funny to what he's doing. And it's absolutely disgusting what he's doing because he sits there on the Senate Judiciary Committee.
Yeah, the separation of powers. You know how that is when you have the legislative body and the judicial branch in the same thing.
And the sheeple don't get it. They just keep patronizing it.
Yep, because he's Al Franken. Or maybe, what's his name out in California? Schwarzenegger.
Yeah.
And Reagan. Reagan was an actor before he was president. He got a lot of face time, right? Everybody needs to wake up. These are all presentations. This is designed and engineered to get you to call it father. Because if you're patronizing it, then it can take care of you the way that it's taking care of you. And we had another caller on tonight. And I'm sorry that my phone went dead. I'm trying to charge it now. But we had another caller on tonight who was raised by this crap.
Let's see. Senator Reid on cattle battle. It's not over. Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid hasn't been very vocal about the cattle battle showdown in recent days, but says it's not over. Reid tells News 4, Samantha Boatman, his take on the so-called cattle battle in southern Las Vegas. Well, it's not over. We can't have an American people that violate the law and then just walk away from it. So it's not over, Reid says. Okay. Yeah. You want to elaborate on that? Because that's just disgusting to me.
They're all showmen. Okay, here's Senator Reid. He sits up there on these committees. He's the one that's raising this, and he's saying, well, it's their fault. No, it's their fault. It's their fault. It's their fault. My hands are tied. That's what he's saying in this thing. My hands are tied. He's Congress.
Harry Reid's donor, Harvey Whitmore, has plans to commercially develop that land the Bundy Ranch is currently on. See, Mr. Bundy, your ranch happens to be on our land here where, you know, we're going to develop some stuff here, so you got to go. Let's see. And then Harry Reid's son, Rory Reid, was hired by Chinese energy firm ENN Energy Group to obtain the land for a solar power plant, purchasing $38 million worth of public lands for just $4.5 million in a sweetheart deal. The Bundy family purchased all that land in 1877, and so now, you know, to only have it seized by the government in the 1930s, and... You know, it just shows you how they've been raising this ranch over time. Really, it's quite disgusting. But you know, these people that don't get it, like what's this guy's name again? Silly
Pete.
Yeah.
You said.
Yeah, Pete Sanchilli or something like that. You know, he's on one side he's saying, "Yeah, we got to stand up for our constitutional rights," and on the other hand, he's saying, you know, let's get John McCain in here. You know, maybe he'll stand behind us and give us a $5 billion like they did in the UK.
It's absolutely disgusting.
That was ridiculous on its face because, how do I even articulate
right.
That?
So here I am at Timez. You can go to timez.loc.gov, which is the Library of Congress, okay? Okay, you have McCain coming in, Reduce Unnecessary Spending Act of 2011, a bill to designate the United States Courthouse under construction at 98 West 1st Street, Yuma, Arizona, as the John M. Roll United States Courthouse. Now, you guys need to read these bills, and you need to read the sponsorship on these bills, and it gets worse. Now, these are under the Reclamation Act, so he's claiming that courthouse. A bill to clarify the jurisdiction of the Secretary of Interior with respect to C.C. Craig and Dam and Reservoir and for other purposes. He's raising that land. He's taking the Dam and Reservoir. Andean Trade Preference Extension Act of 2011, Burn Area Flood Prevention Act of 2011. Stop raising it and it won't flood. Stop getting your insurance agents out there to flood things. Stop directing the Corps of Engineers to build levees that bust. A bill to amend the Flood Conservation and Energy Act to repeal a duplicate program relating to inspection and grading catfish. This is what you're paying them for, folks. Mojave Valley Land Conveyance Act of 2011. Hello? Conveyancing. Military Detainee Procedures Improvement Act of 2011. Debt Buy-Down Act. GSE Bailout Elimination and Taxpayer Protection Act. Border Security Enforcement Act of 2011. Off-Reservation Land Acquisition Guidance Act. Hello? Tutoring for Students Act, Postal Reform Act, Northern Arizona Mining Continuity Act of 2011, Defense Cost Type Contracting Reform Act of 2011, And you guys need to go look at these things because they're killing CIA agents. They're charging CIA agents for grooming defense corporations this last year. That's their job. Go read these acts. Professional Boxing Amendments Acts. Now, that comes out of the 1953 treaty with the Republic of Korea. That's part of the Gambling Commission. Wildfire Suppression Aircraft Transfer Act. A concurrent resolution expressing the sense of Congress that John Arthur Jack Johnson should receive a posthumous pardon for the racially motivated conviction in 1913 that diminished the athletic culture and his heroic significance of Jack Johnson and unduly tarnished his reputation. This is what Senator John McCain does. He's an actor.
You know, and to show you how much they want this in the public's eye, I guess Clyde and Bundy was on today's show earlier with Glenn Beck.
And for all of you that are watching these things in Syria and Libya, here's John McCain, number 25, Senate Resolution 102, a resolution calling for a no-fly zone and the recognition of the Transitional National Council in Libya. This Senator McCain is passing resolutions for a corporation that the Senate owns called Libya. You are paying for them to raise your brothers and sisters as they teach you that these are somebody else. These are not you. They're separate from you. They're called Libya. Senate members passing resolutions to pass no-fly zones over their little territories mean they own those territories. Wake up. Stop patronizing these things. A resolution expressing the sense of the Senate on United States military operations in Libya. Here's your snake speaking out both sides of the mouth here.
Yeah, here's how corporations take care of you in this example. GM sends recall notice to parents after son killed in car. And that $1 part, they knew about for how many years? 3 or 4 years?
Yep.
So this is how corporations take care of you. This is how that Constitution takes care of you with that 14th Amendment in there. Not to mention the Commerce Clause, which I talk about continuously. And we didn't even touch upon the letters of mark and reprisal that allows for the police state to do these things to you. So, but that's about all the headlines. I think we about covered everything for a Monday roundup here.
Absolutely, and we'll be back soon as whenever we need to. And, of course, the Bon Rocco Show every Wednesday, 10 to 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. Leaving the Farm, Thursdays, 8 to 10 on Studio B. He's on Studio A. I'm on Studio B, 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Thursdays. And on Fridays, Bo and I have the Public Law Show on These Changing Times at thesechangingtimes.ning.com. That's times with a Z. And on Saturday, we've got Leaving the Farm, 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Studio B at freedomslips.com, of course. And in between, we'll keep you updated as we have been. As things pick up, hopefully we'll be able to condense it and become more and more efficient as we go along and give you better and better rundowns without all the fluff.
Yep, so hang in there, read between the lines, quit buying all these concepts, do your own research.
We're going to go out with some...
Hopefully we'll have Rocco back soon. This has gone on way too long. I know we didn't even talk about that at all tonight, but... Man, they are altering my heading something fierce. If they're... You know, if they're thinking they're going to get by without owning up to the fee schedule, they got another thing coming.
Absolutely. And thank you, everybody, for being. We'll go out with Talking Heads live during wartime. Be well.